ranked Hampton Pirates come home tonight to face MEAC foe Morgan State. It's Thursday night, prime time, and it's next on ESPNU. ESPNU Thursday primetime college football presented by Buffalo Wild Wings comes to Armstrong Stadium in Hampton, Virginia as the 12th ranked Pirates of Hampton University host the Bears of Morgan State in a MEAC matchup. Hello everyone, Charlie Neal along with my partner Jay Walker. Welcome to Hampton, Virginia, and this promises to be a classic matchup tonight, Jay, because you have the number one total defensive team in the MEAC in Morgan State going against the number one total offensive team in the MEAC in Hampton University.
When you have this type of matchup, both teams' strength need to show up tonight. If you're Morgan State, you need a defense that's going to create turnovers and get your offense the ball with great field position. In the case of the Hampton Pirates, when you talk about offense, you need to score, score, and score. Score some more.
In addition to having the top defensive team in the MEAC, the Morgan State Bears boast the top rushing team in the MEAC behind Chad Simpson, who's averaging 186 yards a game.
Yeah, you know, if you're Chad Simpson, you're going to get a workout tonight. Coach Don Hill is going to run you till the wheels fall off. If he can have any type of productivity like he did in last week's contest against Winston-Salem State, look for the Bears to put some points on the board.
You know, Hampton University is a three-time defending MEAC champ, so one of the concerns for a lot of the fans around here was how they were going to replace their big play receivers from a year ago. But there are two young men that are letting them and making them forget about last year. We're talking about Kevin Teal and Jeremy Gilchrist.
Well, last year's productivity of the wide receiver was phenomenal. You had to ask a question, how could they replace that? Well, Jeremy Gilchrist and Kevin Teal, they've done a fantastic job. They're not as big as last year's wide receiver core, but they're just as exciting. If you get these guys the ball in open space, they can make exciting things happen because neither one of these young men go down with one single tackle. You have to gang tackle these small guys, but they sure are exciting to watch.
It's the first conference game for the Bears of Morgan State. They haven't beaten Hampton since 2002. It's the home opener for the 12th ranked Pirates, and we'll be back with the opening kickoff from Armstrong Stadium in Hampton, Virginia in just a moment. Back here at Armstrong Stadium on the campus of Hampton University in Hampton, Virginia for this MEAC matchup presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. This is college football prime time along with Jay Walker, Charlie Neal, and looks like it's going to be a pretty good ball game for these two teams tonight. Of course, Donald Hill Ely is the head coach of the Bears of Morgan State in his sixth year and is a product of Joe Taylor, the head coach of the Hampton Pirates, played for him at Virginia Union as a quarterback and also was an assistant coach under him at Hampton University. On the other side of the field, his mentor, Joe Taylor, in his 16th year as the head coach, the third winningest head coach in Division 1AA, or as we call it now, the Football Championship Subdivision.
He's a dean. You know, you talk about Coach Taylor, he's the dean of MEAC coaches, and what a dean to have with all the success he's had down here at Hampton in this Pirate football program.
24-4 at home in the last 5 years for the Hampton Pirates. They don't lose very many here at Armstrong Stadium.
Must be something in the crab or something down here, or the salt water in the bay. The teams come up here and just know that when you once you get off the bus, don't expect to win a football contest.
As Jonathan Skeet you're looking at is Morgan State in their visiting white jerseys will be kicking off. As we look at it, left to right to the Hampton Pirates wearing the dark jerseys. And the deep men to return this kick for the Pirates of Hampton. One of them is Mario Melton, a correction rather. One of them is Herbert Bynes. And the other is Gilchrist. Or make that Dennis Mathis is back there. So this one about to get underway. It'll come down to Teal. Very dangerous return man at the 10-yard line. Here comes Kevin Teal up the sideline and still breaking tackles and gets it all the way out to about the 32-33-yard line. So that's where Hampton will go to work. First down and 10. Their quarterback is T.J. Mitchell, a young man who transferred from West Virginia, did not play at West Virginia, went to high school in the area at Virginia Beach. He's from Virginia Beach, Virginia, at Lansdowne High School. and has thrown three touchdown passes in each of his first two ball games. He threw three in the season opener against Howard University, three last week in their win over the Aggies of North Carolina A&T. First down and 10, and he's working from the shotgun. Puts it up, has a man there who was wide open but couldn't hold on. It was Mike Lloyd, Kyle Lloyd rather, the sophomore from Stafford, Virginia. The offensive line for the Pirates, Michael Ola, Dennis Conley, Justin Gary, Ryan Cave, and Akeem Lamar. The backs and receivers, Van Morgan had a big game last week against the Aggies, over 140 yards, along with Quatrell Payton at the fullback. Teal and Gilchrist are the receivers. Ernie Lomax is the tight end. It is second down and 10. This time they keep it on the ground and they hand it off to Morgan. And Morgan gets out to the 35-yard line. Let's look at the defense for the Bears of Morgan State out of Baltimore, Maryland. The defensive line, Clarence McPherson, Justin Lawrence, and Anthony Young. The linebackers, they play a 3-4. Kofi Nkrumah, Lamar West, Mark Hicks, and Gerald Guyton. And in the secondary, Dakota Bracey, Chris Williams, Kendall Jackson, and Willie Herdeman. Third down and 7. T.J. Mitchell going to the air, and the ball is knocked away or it slipped out of his hands as he tried to get the ball downfield. Had a little pressure up front from Gerald Guyton, number 11 there. Young man out of Edison High down in Miami, Florida. Here he is, number 11.
When you talk about that last possession there, one of the things that's going to take, that's going to have an effect on this game is how long will this drizzle continue to play. It's been drizzling here in the Tidewater area all day, and that field conditions will deteriorate, and will T.J. Mitchell struggle holding on to the football?
Jamal Blanchard is the man to, he's going to punt it away for the Pirates of Hampton University. Jai Wilson is back. He'll field it at the 8-yard line. Ty Wilson, very dangerous, and he has a little seam, and he's still on his feet, spins away, and he's almost at midfield. He's across midfield at about the 49-yard line, so great field position for the Bears of Morgan State on their first offensive possession of the game.
Well, this turned out to be a bad kick. He got plenty of distance, but it was a low-line drive with a bad trajectory, and Jai Wilson just making Pirate defenders miss one-on-one. All that arm tackling on a wet surface is not going to get it done. When conditions are like this, you must get your shoulder into the ball carrier if you plan on bringing them down. Jai Wilson made him pay.
Mario Melton is the quarterback for the Bears that will start the game. Their quarterback has been sacked just once all season long against the Hampton defense that believes in sacks. And now he's going back to pass on first down. Has it complete at the 30, make the 41-yard line. And it is complete to Edwin Baptiste, the wide receiver, sophomore out of Miami Edison High, as the offensive line for Morgan State. Robert Norris, James Key, Nathan Soto, Dwayne Delaney, and Dakari Grimsley. The backs and receivers, Chad Simpson, Roderick Wolf, Aaron Moore, Edwin Baptiste, who just made the last catch, and Sean Simmons is the tight end. It is second down, and we'll call it 1. It's time to keep it on the ground with Chad Simpson getting the first down and plenty to spare all the way down inside the 30 to the 29-yard line. Let's look at the defense for the Pirates of Hampton University. Marcus Dixon, Vernon Bryant, Kendall Langford are the down linemen. The linebackers, Franklin Frazier, Joaquin Good, Demarius Sapp, and Charles Robinson. And the secondary, Sam Pope, Henty Baird, Tobin Lyon, and Jackie Bates.
Important to note that all four members of that Hampton secondary were not starters on this team a year ago, so they're still trying to find their chemistry in the defensive secondary.
First down and 10 for the Bears of Morgan State. Chad Simpson again gets the call. Chad Simpson came into the game today averaging 186 yards a game and 6 yards per carry. So he really gets it done, doesn't he?
He's exciting. I mean, you know, he's the interesting matchup is going to be if he gets an opportunity to break away in the open field, does he have enough speed to outrun this Pirate defense, which is very fast? And take a look there at his production on the year, and he's doing a good job, and his carries are up. Last year he only averaged 12 carries a game. This year he's averaging already closer to 25 carries per game. He's living up to the challenge.
Gain of 2 on the last play, second down and 8. Roll out to the left, little dink pass out in the flat, and it goes incomplete. He's trying to get it to Surratt. Robert Surratt, the sophomore out of Glen Park High in Ogden Hill, Maryland. And it'll bring up a third and eight.
See, and that's what you hate. Now you have third and eight. Surratt was wide open in the flat, but the inexperienced quarterback in Mario Melvin, first year's full-time as a starter. That's why you have a passing attack that's averaging 115 yards per game when you can't hit the simple pass that's wide open in front of you, regardless of the conditions.
He was redshirted in 05. Now he's back to pass on third down, and that one close to being picked off as the defense by Jackie Bates made sure that it was not going to be completed to bring up a fourth down situation for the Bears.
And Melton here trying to stick that curl pattern in there. One of the things you have to do, if you're going to throw a curl, you have to know where the defensive back is. You see the DB is on the left shoulder. You got to make sure you put that ball on the right shoulder for the wide receiver to make the catch, because the wide receiver has his back turned to the defender. He can't see where he's coming from. Bad throw by the quarterback.
44-yard field goal attempt by James Meade. He's hit a 43-yarder already this year. This one is up. It has the distance, and it is no good. Off to the left. So he misses his first one of the season. He was 2 of 2 coming into the night's ball game. So the Hampton Pirates dodged a bullet defensively, and we'll be back.
Strength.
ESPNU College Football is presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. You have to be there. Right here at Armstrong Stadium, 12:07 to go, first quarter. No score. Pirates getting the ball for their second time this evening. And you're looking at Terrell Simmons, a redshirt freshman, who is the long snapper on field goals and punts. And we'll show you, to his dismay, why that field goal may not have been any good that the Bears of Morgan State attempted. And the handoff going to the right side as the Bears come up defensively to stop Van Morgan. But let's look at the snap here. It's high. And
great job by the Bees. Thomas Bees did a great job to get it down. Fantastic job. And yesterday when we saw practice, Terrell Simmons missed a couple of punt long snaps high.
Right.
And it seems like he hasn't made the adjustment. He was good on his field goal snaps yesterday, but his punt snaps were high. May have some nerves, and that could have cost the Bears 3 points.
And that's all he does is center the ball.
As Coach Hill alluded to.
Little swing pass out of the flat. And not much running room on the near side as the catch is made by Gilchrist. Rashad West, or Lamar West, there to make the stop defensively for the Bears of Morgan State.
And that's great team defense. Anytime you've got an offense that's going to run that little wide receiver bubble screen, as they like to call it, you've got to get a defense that swarms to the ball. And anytime you get your interior linebackers, like Lamar West is, number 40, hustling down the line of scrimmage, you've got to gang tackle those little guys. That's team defense to the point of attack.
Gilchrist goes to the far side, the top of your screen. Third down conversions this year. 13 of 20 for the Pirates of Hampton University coming into the night's contest. Again on third and long, Van Morgan stays into the backfield, and he throws out there, overthrown, incomplete. No chance for Kyle Lloyd to bring that one down. I thought he had a better chance of hitting Van Morgan, who was open. He released out of the backfield and did a little curl in front of the linebacker.
Yeah, Van Morgan was open on the check down, and what you saw there was T.J. Mitchell trying to force the ball to Kyle Lloyd. It was actually a bad read because the outside linebacker, Kofi Nkumra, did a good job of running underneath the skinny eight, doing curl to flat coverage, playing great zone concept.
The first punt for Blanchard was a 57-yarder, but they had a great return. He gets off another one. This time it will not be returned by the Morgan punt returner, Jai Wilson. And it'll be down at the 24-yard line. Morgan State, located in Baltimore, Maryland, one of the original schools in the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference that was formed in 1970. They came into the conference, stayed until 79, and then went away and came back in 84. And they have 7,000 students. It was founded in 1867. Some of the famous alumni, Willie Lanier, Hall of Famer, Frenchie Fuqua. Of course, their president is Dr. Earl Richardson. First down and 10 now for the Bears of Morgan State. Little swing pass out in the flat on the far sideline, and running with it is Devin James. Devin James, one of those Florida kids on this Morgan team from Florida, Pompano Beach, Hampton University, of course, in the MEACs since 1995. Founded in 1867, over 6,000 students. Of course, Wanda Sykes went here. Rick Mahorn, one of the bad boys.
Bad boys.
Bill Harvey, Dr. Harvey, is the president.
And both these schools have great presidents. You're talking about fixtures on campus that have seen their schools grow to phenomenal levels, and they do a great job of administering these at their school.
And here's a complete pass on the far sideline for the Bears of Morgan State, and Aaron Moore is on the reception. Aaron Moore with a good move, and he takes it down the field. The junior out of Owens Mills, Maryland, and picks up the first down for the Bears.
Simple hitch pattern, but I like the fact that once he caught the ball, he became aggressive. So often, the wide receiver just runs out of bounds to the sideline, but Aaron Moore felt where the defensive back was, knew he could get away and gain a couple extra yards on the inside. Great job of catching the football and then running second by Aaron Moore.
At the 42, it's first down and 10 for the Bears. Moore throws in the middle of the field, and it's incomplete. Again, Aaron Moore, the intended receiver, he had it momentarily, but it was knocked loose by Jackie Bates, and he had some help from his friends down there on the defensive side of the ball.
So many quarterbacks, young quarterbacks, try and drill that ball in there on that slant route. You really don't have to throw a bullet pass when a guy that's running a slant pattern coming at you. As you see there, he threw that ball right on the helmet, but if you throw it so hard, it's going to get through anybody's hand. So I'd like to see young quarterbacks throw a crisp pass instead of a bullet pass on slant patterns.
Going back to the air once again. This one knocked away by Bates. Bates has been on a number of plays so far. That's a young man who transferred from Oregon, from Vallejo, California, went to De La Salle High out there, and he's made a couple big defensive plays.
Yeah, you know, and actually, this route was wide open. Roderick Wolf, and Roderick Wolf goes up to try and catch that ball, and when he tries to bring it down, Bates does a good job of separating his hands, but to let you know how inaccurate the throw was, Wolf is 6 feet, 4 inches tall, and he climbed the ladder, and he still couldn't come down, so quarterback's got to put that ball in his gut where he can come down with the reception.
They bring up a third down and 10 now for the Bears of Morgan State. Under pressure, Melton steps up, throws it long, and this one is not going to be complete. Again, Bates covering on the play downfield, Rod Wolf, the intended receiver. And last year, Wolf came up with 29 catches, came into today's game with 10 receptions, and was ranked a preseason poll second team all MEAC.
You see, yes, and you know, we know Wolf can play, and we take a look at Coach Hill talking to his quarterback Mario Melton there. You know, Coach Hill said, hey, I'm gonna give Mario a couple series to settle down and get in some type of rhythm, but if he doesn't do it, I'm gonna have to make a change at the quarterback position. And you can see why in that last series there, or actually the first two series, inaccurate throws, guys wide open, and the quarterback not being able to capitalize on great play calling.
We may see Byron Selby on the next series for the Bears of Morgan State. Meanwhile, Thomas Bees averaging 39 yards per punt is back to punt it away. Gilchrist chasing it, but it's going to go out of bounds. Of course, they were trying to keep it away from Gilchrist, but not one of your more artistic punts.
No style points. No style points, but it was effective. They didn't get a return.
So the ball will be spotted at about the 32, and we'll be back. No score here in Hampton, Virginia in this MEAC matchup between the Bears of Morgan State and the Pirates of Hampton, ranked number 12 in the championship subdivision polls this week. And it is first down and 10, third possession of the evening for the Pirates of Hampton University. And this one is a handoff, and Van Morgan is into the secondary. Van Morgan still on his feet. He's all the way down to the 35-yard line. No flags down of the Bears of Morgan State. So Van Morgan, who had a big game against the Aggies a week ago, 154 yards and two touchdowns, gets a big one that time before Chris Williams made the stop.
Just man-on-man blocking, and the Pirates did a good job of freeing up the offensive line of scrimmage so Morgan could accelerate through there. We talk about Morgan with great size, 6 feet, 225 pounds, but he also showed he has the ability to have that breakaway speed that's needed as well.
33 yards on that run for Van Morgan. First down and 10. T.J. Mitchell under pressure throws it out in the flat to the Peyton, the fullback, and Peyton stumbled and tripped up at about the 24-yard line. And it was Chris Williams again there on the stop defensively.
Strong safety. You're one of my favorite fullbacks here. Fullbacks are supposed to catch the ball and run somebody over. You're trying to prove you got hops. No, don't do that. Run right through that guy. He's a redshirt freshman, strong safety that weighs 180 pounds. Q weighs 255 pounds. I wanted to see some bodies laid out.
First down and 10 for the Bears. I should say for the Pirates of Hampton University. There's Van Morgan again, stuffed at the line of scrimmage. He will not get away this time. And it was right there was Gerald Guyton, who's quite a story in itself out of Miami. Gerald Guyton, Medicine High, started his college career at Dodge City Community College, has great instincts, ranked the number one tackler in the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference, and you can see why.
Yeah, I mean, he's an active ball player. And, you know, something about those guys in Florida. They know how to run with the football, and they know how to hit people. Cover skills and be a little suspect, minus Deion Sanders, but they can run and they can tackle.
It is second down after no gain on the last play. T.J. Mitchell again standing in there throwing and is complete to Kevin Teal on the far sideline, who has another first down. And the chains move again for the Pirates of Hampton University all the way down to, they're going to move it at about the 10-yard line.
And that was a great job by T.J. Mitchell of going through his reads, not forcing the ball. He wanted to go vertical with the post route. It wasn't there. Went to his second read, which was Kevin Teal in the flat. And there's no problem getting the ball to a guy like Kevin Teal, your secondary read, because you know the first guy's not going to bring him down.
This time they handed a little scat back Mathis, the freshman. And Mathis gets maybe a yard. His first and goal, that was a first and goal run, and his second down and goal. Kendall Jackson there to make the stop defensively. And Dennis Mathis, he's wearing a number worn by Alonzo Coleman a year ago. In fact, the funny thing is, when he first decided to come to Hampton, he said, I want number 22. Then when he got here, he got cold feet. He said, no, I don't want that number because I don't want to be compared to Alonzo Coleman, who had over 4,000 rushing yards here. But coach said, you ask for it, you're going to get it. And he looks so much like Alonzo, doesn't he?
Very exciting. And both of them had impact careers as freshmen. You knew early in their career they were going to be special. And Coach Taylor's just hoping that Mathis can have half the career and productivity that Alonzo Coleman had.
I believe that was a kind of a busted play. T.J. Mitchell had to run with the ball. It looked like everybody wasn't on the same page as far as the Pirates were concerned. And there's a penalty marker down, the first one of the ball game.
You know, this is one of those cases where if it's against Hampton, I really don't like when I see young quarterbacks, or quarterbacks period, go for a snap count on two or three inside the red zone.
Snap infraction, offense, number 74. Remains second down.
We're talking about Alonzo Coleman, what he meant to this Hampton program, the first 4,000-yard rusher at Hampton University, all-time leading rusher in the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference. He broke Montrell Coley's record. Montrell Coley had 3,838 yards and 49 touchdowns, but this young man has 62 rushing touchdowns throughout his career, had two pass reception touchdowns, and finished with 64. He's exciting, and he's a member of the Dallas Cowboys today.
Don't they look alike? I mean, you see that 22 there, and I don't like to put that pressure on the kid, but I was actually talking to offensive coordinator for Hampton, Corey Sullivan, before the game, and he said, you know, we don't want to put that pressure on him either, but wow, he sure does run like Alonzo when he gets on that corner. So they're high, and they're thinking, hey, we get 1 year in the weight room with this young man, he can be a special player down here in Pirate Land.
Yeah, he was the first team All-State and the player of the year in high school at Defebus High in Hampton. 2,148 yards, 21 touchdowns, and they won a state championship at Phoebus High.
Seems like every year when you look at the rankings in terms of the state champions in the state of Virginia, they're always coming from somewhere down here, whether it's Hampton High, Bethel High, Phoebus High, Tab High, even back with Chris Slade, Terry Kirby. State champs always are just bred down here in the Tidewater area.
It'll be second down and goal, but the ball is spotted at the 13-yard line for the Pirates of Hampton. This time, a play action. And just thrown out there. It should be intercepted. And it is a touchdown.
Oh, whoa.
It's caught. Somehow, coming up with the big reception for the Pirates of Hampton University is Marcus Dixon. Marcus Dixon comes up with it. Where he came from, nobody knows.
The defensive end showing that he's got some athleticism there. They lined him up as a secondary tight end on that one, and he showed he's an athlete as well as being a starting defensive end for the Pirates.
Got a chance to talk to him a little bit yesterday. I'll tell you, he's one of the twin tires, like you said, on the defensive side. That is his first touchdown reception in his college career. He'll always remember that one. And the point after by Giovanni is good, and Hampton draws first blood with 7:01 to go. And again, from 13 yards out, it's thrown up for grabs. It looks like it was going to be picked off, but somehow the big fella, Marcus Dixon, pulled it down. All-time winningest coach at Hampton University. His team out in front, 7-0. Joe Taylor, scoring drive, 6 plays, 68 yards. And they used 2:45 off the clock, and Marcus Dixon said, look what I found.
Touchdown. Not the way you draw it up, but hey, there are no style points in football. At the end of the day, the end result, 7 points, giving the Pirates the lead.
Chad Simpson, one of the deep men, to return the kickoff by Jamal Blanchard, and it'll be Chad Simpson, all-purpose runner, coming up the field and still on his feet. Hurdles one man across midfield, still going, and finally knocked out of bounds at the 45 of Hampton by Darius Mullen, who saved the day because Mr. Simpson refused to go down.
You know, and I think that's what's going to help him play football in the National Football League. The fact that he can return kicks is special. We know he's a great running back. When you've got his size and stature, they want to see what all you can do, and you see him making Pirates miss one at a time, and a little woo action there and a little woo action there, and he still couldn't be brought down by just one defender.
Second time today that the Bears have started in Hampton territory, and Byron Selby is now in at quarterback for the Bears of Morgan State. And he just hands off to Simpson, and Simpson runs straight ahead, gains maybe 4 yards on the play. It'll be second down and 6. But Byron Selby out of Baltimore, Maryland, he started the first half of the season last year, and in fact against Hampton University, he completed 8 of 13 passes for 85 yards and a touchdown. In fact, in 05, 2 years ago, he led the MEAC in passing with 2,023 yards and 18 touchdowns, and he's in the ball game right now. Second down and 6. Simmons, the tight end, is the man in motion. Selby going to the air, throws it, just short-armed it to Simmons, the tight end. Transfer from Arkansas Fayetteville, just had saw the ball bounce in front of him.
You know, one of the things when you talk about Byron Selby, why he's no longer the starting quarterback for Morgan, he had a tendency to hold on to the football a little bit. Coach Hill wants an offense that's predicated on timing and efficiency. Selby's a quarterback that's a read and react type guy. He's a great runner, but in terms of making the read in the pocket, not as comfortable as he would like to be.
Third down now for the Bears of Morgan State. Simmons again moving in motion. Here's a delayed draw to Simpson. Simpson trying to break the tackle and cannot get away from the linebacker, Joaquin Good.
I'll tell you what, that was what you call a touchdown-saving tackle.
It was.
Had Simpson been able to pull his right leg free along with his shoe, he had daylight all day long to the end zone with no Pirate defenders in front of him.
So they move the ball 7 yards down to the 38. They come up with a 4th and 3, and that'll bring on the punter for the Bears, Thomas Bees. Jeremy Gilchrist, the deep man, to return this one. Kicking it high. Gilchrist calling for the fair catch, but it takes a Hampton bounce and comes back to the 25-26-yard line. Now let's join Lowell Galindo in the studio for SportsCenterU in game.
Guys, Miami took it right.
Well, kind of interesting, huh? Texas A&M ranked 20th in the nation. Miami coming into that game 2-1. And
say what you want about the Canes.
Yeah.
It's always going to be tough to beat them in the bowl. You know, I know they're getting ready to move to Joe Robbie Stadium, but I just know my lasting images of the bowl are going to be that smoke and the Canes not losing too many football games at home. It's going to be a good one.
From their own 26, Hampton University Gains maybe a yard or two on the play. Running the ball for the Pirates this time. Rasul. Correction. In the lineup right now, they have Van Morgan. There he is, number 27. Kevin Beverly was the man who had started this season for them. He got injured, an ankle injury against Howard University in their season opener, and they've held him out the last couple of ball games. He wants to play, but coach says, I'd rather have you completely healthy than partially healthy. And this one is caught in the middle of the field by Kevin Teal. Or is that Gilchrist? Gilchrist down the sideline, still on his feet. And he touchdown. Is going to score. Gilchrist takes it all the way. 73 yards.
And if you blink, you missed it, because when he turned on the burners, it was over.
It's so hard to distinguish 19 and 16, the way they run and catch and do so many things good after the ball. Like we said in the opener, they had big play receivers a year ago, and Faulkner and Andre Jones and Marquay McDaniel, and now they have the quick sixes, they like to call themselves.
They call themselves the quick six. I call them the Rugrats. Tough to catch, but, you know, they both go 5'9", 5'9", and a half. They look alike, but they have one common denominator. They're very aggressive when they get that football in their hands, and they're explosive with the run-after-catch yards. Take a look here, T.J. Mitchell. All he's waiting for Gilchrist to do is clear that linebacker. Once he cleared that linebacker, Mark Keats trying to drop into soft zone coverage with too much space. This is a guy that can make it happen in the wide open place. And Jeremy Gilchrist getting a block there from his partner. See, that's what you like. Teammates got to stick together. Jeremy Gilchrist getting in the end zone. Kevin Teal with a block down there. And let's take a look to see, did he actually get in? Yeah, well, you know, hey, those last two steps were questionable. But the key thing is you got to get the ball across the goal line. He got the ball there, and that might have been the distracting factor, because the official seemed as if he missed those last two steps.
Yeah,
on the
because
line.
He was outrun.
The official couldn't keep up with him.
He couldn't keep up. He wanted to know whether he got into the end zone or not himself.
He was guessing, but I mean, wow, that's explosive. You know, this is why this Hampton Pirate team is so tough to beat. If you're going to come in here and have a chance at victory, you got to play well on offense, defense, and special teams. And, you know, you don't want to. It's tough to say the Morgan State defense is playing well because they've given up 14 points, but Hampton's had to work hard for it. And I think just the number of plays. I mean, the offense just kept fizzling, even when they had great field possession. And you can't ask your defense to keep somebody out of the offense time and time again.
Chad Simpson from the 8. Chad Simpson trying to dig to the corner, trying to turn it upfield, and reverses his field, gets a block, and still on his feet. He has great balance, doesn't he? I mean, he was hit two or three times and somehow managed to stay on his feet. Gets the ball all the way out to the 29-yard line before Gerard Griffin made the stop, but there's a penalty marker down.
I think when Chad decided to come back and cut against the grain,
somebody got a deep block in the back. Yep. Here it is from our referee, Andre Lowe. So Morgan State getting the ball for the fourth time today. Hampton went three and out on their first two possessions, scored their last two.
We had a block above the waist, 56 on the receiving team, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
Onyeka, young man out of Plainfield, New Jersey, Greg Onyeka, was the man guilty of the infraction. So that'll move the ball all the way back to the 12, 13-yard line. Melton is back in the lineup for the Bears. Trailing 14 to nothing. Melton going to the air, throws, has it complete. First down for the Bears of Morgan State. And on the catch is Rod Wolf. Quite a story in itself. The senior out of Baltimore, Maryland Edmondson High, young man who was homeless in high school and spent a lot of time sleeping in his car. In fact, didn't play in their game a week ago. He was picked up by the police in Baltimore on his way to the ball game because he failed to pay a traffic ticket, and they had a warrant out for him. Well, he didn't do anything bad. He just didn't get the mail that he was supposed to go to court to pay that ticket.
That's one of those cases where, because of his background, and talking about a young man that lost both of his parents by the time he was 19, and because he's been homeless and on his own, he relies on campus housing with the scholarship. And they were doing some renovations in the dormitory at Morgan State, and that dorm was closed for the summer, so the mail was sitting there in the school mailbox. He didn't get it, and bad things happen when you don't get your mail. He learned
the hard way.
The hard way.
He was on his way to the game last week, and he got picked up. He spent the night in the jail, but he got out on Sunday morning, and he's here playing today. Kind of an unfortunate incident, not because he did anything wrong. He had a man out there, and that was Wolf again. That was Melton, but Melton didn't see him. A little quick hitch pattern. That was a second down play, and he's going to be about a yard shy, maybe two, make it 3 yards shy of a first down.
And coaches can live with that decision. If you don't feel comfortable in the pocket with your throwing lane, just don't force the ball in there where you get an incompletion and you don't get any positive yards. So a coach can settle with a running back scrambling for a 5 yard pickup, give them some positive yardage to give them third and less than 3 or 4 yards. They like that.
0 for 3 in third down conversions tonight for the Bears of Morgan State, and they're facing a third and 2 right now at their own 36 yard line with 3:20 to go in the first quarter. Quarterback's going to keep it. He's not going to get there. He is not going to get there as the defense of the Hampton Pirates was stiff. Kendall Lankford leading the way defensively, number 98.
I think the whole defensive unit for Hampton knew that the quarterback was going to call that draw. And once he did that, I mean, you had cornerbacks coming up playing cover two force, forcing the quarterback to go inside, and 4 or 5 Pirate defenders there to stop Melton short.
So Thomas Bees will punt it away for the third time today. They attempted a field goal of 44 yards and went wide to the left on their first possession. They drove down the field trying to score, something they haven't done in the first possession in a long time. Gets off a good kick this time.
Oh!
This one is hit, and do we have a penalty flag down? Yes, because they did not allow the receiver to make the catch. Interference with the catch.
That's tough. Tough call, because you got a wide receiver that's running hard to his right, and you've got a, you know, that the Morgan State defender was running in his lane on the outside. If you got a moving target that's running towards you, what are you supposed to do? Start backing up as he's running towards you?
I understand what you're saying, but
that's,
I know
it's a tough one. I actually thought that was a great special teams play. He didn't hit him before he got the ball. As the ball got there, you know, he made the collision there, and that's going to be unfortunate. They're going to call that.
Morgan thinks they have the ball. They got the ball, but listen to our. They're going to call interference with the opportunity to make a catch. And let's see it once again, as you were talking about it, Jay.
He's running over there to him on the right. So when the ball gets there, I mean, he's running in his lane trying to get outside of him, and they get there at the same time. See, he was in a full sprint. Gilchrist was in a full sprint to get there. You know.
Kick catch interference.
He had the ball before he was hit. He was actually touched. If we had replay, of course, Donald Hill Ealy cannot be happy with that. But if you look at it, and if they had the benefit of replay in this conference, and they were reviewing it, and you had a replay official, they would reverse that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, because he touched that ball there, and that's just unfortunate. It didn't go that way. And, you know, you want the officials to realize everything that's going on that play. We saw clearly that, you know, he wasn't trying to hit him, didn't go out of his way. And Gilchrist in a full sprint, what can you do? You put the defender in no man's land.
Gary Parks was the man they said was guilty of the infraction. So Hampton gets the ball first and 10 after the penalty at their own 40-yard line, their fifth possession of the day. 2:28 to go, and we're in the first quarter, and they lead it 14 to nothing. Dancing is Van Morgan, and Van Morgan, not much running room for him there, as he is brought down by Lamar West, the linebacker out of Irvington, New Jersey, number 40. First year starting. He was a backup for 3 years, but we'll look at the punt one more time and see. That ball got there just before he was hit by the defender.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's just an unfortunate play there, and that's what happens there. And, you know, one thing about Morgan State, they average 120 yards per game.
That's the most in the conference.
Yep. Well, actually, they got them there at ninth. Yeah, then
last
ninth year
means they get more penalties than anybody
last year,
else.
They led the MEAC in penalties called on them, too.
They still do, yeah, 80-some yards. So they've increased their penalty yard. And now we got an interference penalty. Derek McPherson, a young man who transferred from Illinois, one of 8 children, trying to get into the pass pattern that time. When you talk about transfers on this Hampton University team. 8 Division I transfers, including their starting quarterback, T.J. Mitchell, their running back, Kevin Beverly, transferred from Kent State. T.J. from West Virginia, of course. Jeremy Gilchrist came out of Virginia Tech. They're calling face mask. And then Derek McPherson, the young man who was just trying to make that reception that time. He transferred from Illinois. You also have Sam Pope, came out of South Carolina.
Face mask, defense, number 5, 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Also Jackie Bates from Oregon, Vaughn Mansfield, Utah State, and Kevin Burke from West Virginia. There's the penalty right there.
That's definitely not a face mask. I mean, he grabbed a little bit of jersey, but the hands were nowhere near the face mask there. So Morgan State right now, they're not, you know, getting beat on the field, and they're also getting beat with the whistle and the flags.
And they're keeping the ball on the ground again. Kendall Jackson on the stop defensively of Van Morgan.
You know, when you talk about the Division 1A transfers that are here now playing in the football championship subdivision, the key is, you know, when the 1AA schools go out and recruit, they're recruited for long term. You know, the key to a good program is not who you have on your campus that you recruited last year, but who did you have that is new to your campus that wasn't on your football team last year. That's where you find these transfers like a Jackie Bates that can come in and fill in the secondary. And you talk about, you know, when you look at Morgan State, you know, Chad Simpson, the transfer from University of South Florida. So the key with all 1AA programs are who are some of the transfers you have coming in that drop down a level that are impact players right away.
No question. And you talk about the new divisions. 1A now is the football bowl subdivision. Of course, 1AA, the football championship subdivision, or the FCS or the FBS.
But don't we wish they were all championship subdivisions where they could play it on the field?
No question.
Get rid of the rankings and let's just play it out loud.
TJ under a little pressure, steps in, throws, has it complete. First down. Down to the 21-22-yard line is Keel, Kevin Teal, Darren McCon there to stop him defensively. Darren McCon back in the lineup this week after serving a 1-game suspension for missing team meetings.
And watch the patience here by TJ Mitchell. He's waiting, get open, get open. Now he's open and he throws a strike to hit Teal right in stride between the 1 and the 6. Great patience by TJ Mitchell, waiting out the man-to-man coverage, allowing Teal to separate before he delivered the football.
TJ has his team poised to strike once again. Van Morgan trying to turn the corner, and Van Morgan finds the rough, going a little rough on the far sideline as he is hit immediately by McPherson. Clarence McPherson there defensively as the first quarter comes to an end here in Hampton, Virginia, with the Pirates of Hampton ranked 12th in the championship subdivision, leading the Bears of Morgan State 14-0. They're knocking on the door, and we'll be back. Third down and 8 for the Pirates of Hampton University. The ball at the 19-yard line. It is third down. They ran a play while we were away on second down, and it was incomplete, trying to hit Jeremy Gilchrist at the goal line. A catch he made a week ago, a circus catch. He just couldn't hold on this time. So it is third down and 8 facing the Pirates of Hampton University. The ball at the 19 of the Bears of Morgan State. Morgan, the man in motion. Mitchell looking in and out of the hands again, this time of Jeremy Gill, or make that Kevin Teal, as Chris Williams was there to strip him of the football.
Yeah, there was a soft spot in that zone, and Teal did a good job of settling in the zone, but took TJ Mitchell just a little bit too long holding on to the ball to deliver the ball there. Take a look at the first quarter. We call it ball control. I mean, Hampton tells you the explosive they had. I mean, they had some drives they were going, and had they not had the big plays, they could have run 25 plays. That Morgan State defense was on the field that long. And if you're Morgan State, you got to find a way that can win that battle of time of possession.
36-yard field goal is no good by Hampton's Carlo Turvani, and that's the first field goal attempt he's missed this season. He was 2 of 2 coming in. had a 28-yarder last week against the Aggies of A&T, hit a 20-yarder against Howard, missed this one tonight. Here in the second quarter, 14:30, the time remaining, 14-0, Hampton on top of the Bears of Morgan State. First down and 10 for the Bears, the ball at their own 20-yard line. And it's Chad Simpson going to the right. Chad Simpson getting some yardage, and Chad Simpson still on his feet. And somehow this young man, I could see why he had 200 and some yards a week ago, finally brought down by Jamari Jones on the defensive side, number 54, but not before he gets the first down for the Bears of Morgan State.
Yeah, he didn't see Jamari Jones coming, and Jamari made a hard tackle from the backside, probably drove Chad to the turf. Let's take a look here. Simpson does a good job of waiting for the block, setting up, then explode to the outside, makes a cut, trying to get those extra yards, and all of a sudden, whap, here comes Jamari Jones, and guarantee you what got him there was the shoulder on the turf. Not the hit itself, but getting driven into the ground tears up the shoulder every time.
Devin James in there right now, and it comes to Devin James coming to the near side, and Devin James breaks a tackle. He's still on his feet, and Devin James
face mask too.
Gets across the 40 to about the 42-yard line. Kendall Langford there defensively for the Pirates, number 98. But boy, look at Devin James out of Pompano Beach, Florida, with from Ely High. Had a ACL that ended his career early last season.
Well, you see him duck underneath there. You know, they tried to grab him. They even tried to grab him by the dreadlocks there, and that couldn't bring him down. But, you know, what you're seeing now is Morgan State realizing, hey, Hampton's too strong in the trenches to run right at him, so we have to attack the edges and run on the perimeter.
Play action now. Melton throws it underground, and it goes incomplete. Wolf is going to try to sell some Wolf tickets to the officials, but they're not going to buy it.
He was trying to get it, but that ball skipping there, we all knew that. But this is one where a quarterback, your first down, anytime a coach calls a pass play on first down, he just wants a completion. Didn't have to be 10 yards, didn't have to be 15 yards. He had a check down 3 yards in front of him, wide open. Instead of having second and 7, now you got second and 10.
Wolf is at the bottom of your screen. They're going to the right side this time. Melton look intercepted by Good. Good comes up with the INT. Joaquin Good at the 45-yard line. So the first turnover of the ball game.
That's how you play linebacker. When you talk about linebackers, they're taught drop curl to flat. So the first thing you're looking for is a curl to run underneath. And you see Joaquin Good there running underneath the curl route and reading the quarterback's eyes. And Mario Melton blessed him with an early Christmas present.
And that's one of the things Donald Hill Ely was concerned about, was turnovers. They have turned the ball over more than he would like to so far this season. I mean, there's a team that's fumbled 6 times, lost 2, has thrown 3 interceptions. And you cannot win ball games giving it to the opposition.
And this is a very talented team. I mean, you got a great running back. You've got good wide receiver. Quarterback doesn't get sacked.
T.J. Mitchell looking for Teal. And he's knocked away from the football by Darren McCon.
Good job there of playing the inside-out coverage on Kevin Teal. You got a safety coming from over top, and the safety delivering the blow on Kendall Jackson. Take a look at T.J. Mitchell. He's got a big arm, so he thinks he can squeeze this ball in between McCarron and Kendall Jackson. And McCarron, the cornerback's got to do a good job of undercutting that ball. If you're going to take that type of angle and go for the undercut, you got to get your hands in the football. And that ball hit T.J. Teal right in the face.
Yes. Here we go to the right side this time. Hampton with Van Morgan trying to sweep. I'll make that correction. Mathis trying to sweep to the near side. And let's go to Lowell Galindo in the studio for an update.
Yeah, let's get you updated on Western Kentucky and Middle Tennessee. This is DeMarco McNair pounding it in from 2 yards out for the Blue Raiders. Touchdown number 2 for McNair this season. We're all tied up at 10.
All right. Right here, it's 14-0. Hampton, let's see if they can take advantage of the turnover they just created by coming up with the interception. Van Morgan this time. And Van Morgan gets the first down with plenty to spare. And he's down to the 31-yard line of the Bears of Morgan State. We're at Hampton, Virginia for Thursday night primetime college football presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. Along with Jay Walker, I'm Charlie Neal. Of course, the Bears of Morgan State in the visiting white jerseys. And they're taking on the 12th-ranked Pirates of Hampton University.
The three-time defending MEAC champion Pirates of Hampton University.
And Morgan again on the carry.
When people ask the difference of Hampton, you know, what are the questions that have to be answered? I think it's going to be the running game. You're talking about an offense that typically has two rushers with almost 1,000 yards. And this offensive line is so young, so young. They've got one senior, and then they got three sophomores and a freshman.
Mm-hmm.
That is going to be the real test. How quickly can these young men grow up on the offensive front to allow Hampton to keep that running game that they've always had the ability to rely on when the passing game wasn't there?
Talking about Akeem Lamar being the only senior on that offensive line. Here's T.J. Mitchell with plenty of time. Throws, and not a good throw by T.J., the quarterback. He came into today's game as the number one rated passer in the MEAC and number one in total offense, but that didn't look too good that time.
Well, you know, what he had was stat day against North Carolina A&T. You know, would think everybody should move up in the rankings in passing.
Well, he's thrown three touchdown passes in his first two games. Each game, he threw three against Howard, three against A&T. He's already thrown two here tonight.
One of them was a gift. It was a great play by Marcus Dixon, and the other one was just outstanding play by Jeremy Gilchrist. But if, you know, but I don't fault him for that. If you continue to get the ball to those people in space, good things are going to happen. It's knowing your personnel, where to go with the football.
Morgan in the backfield with the quarterback. Here's TJ. Standing in there, has some running room, takes off, cuts it back, still on his feet, gets the first down. Smart play that time by T.J. Mitchell out of Virginia Beach, Virginia. He was redshirted at West Virginia back in 05 before transferring here.
Anytime a team plays cover two man-to-man coverage, nobody's in the passing game is there to account for the quarterback. So the quarterback becomes the running offense. Everybody turns their back to T.J. Mitchell. What does he do? Run and pick up the first down.
All the way down to the 20-yard line of the Bears of Morgan State. And this is what he did a week ago, 12 of 22, 210, and three touchdowns. Pretty good afternoon for him last week. Trying to come to the near side this time is the freshman, Dennis Mathis. It was so interesting. I heard one of the fans in the stand, one of them looks like, sound like a mom or grandma. When he was being thrown away, she says, wait a minute here. Don't be hurting the young man.
Let go of my baby. Every now and then, the grandmamas and the aunties and the mamas forget this is football. Try to hit him as hard as you can on the defensive front. And anytime a defensive end gets his hands on a running back, he's going to try and make him pay. And Brian Wilson doesn't get the opportunity to make too many tackles. So what defensive linemen like to do when they get their hands on you, they like to make you pay.
No question. A loss of six on the play. Morgan in motion, and it's second down and 16, and we have movement on the line. One of the up men got Nicholas Royal, I believe.
False start, 55 offense, 5 yards from the previous spot, remains second down.
You know, the offensive line was a concern of Coach Taylor going into camp, but Coach Lawrence Kershaw erased all those doubts, has done a fantastic job with the offensive line.
You know, and that's, they got tradition. You know, they've got a tradition. When you go back from, you know, from all the great offensive line they've had here that can run and produce, it's just a system of protecting the quarterbacks and running backs here.
Wide open in the middle of the field as Gilchrist breaks a tackle, still on his feet, 10, 5, still on his feet, and finally knocked out of bounds at about the 1 yard line by Rasul. Correction, make that Kofi Nkrumah made the stop defensively. Boy, Jeremy Gilchrist is exciting. And you know, you talk to Kevin Teal, he said, call me Mr. Excitement. But look at Mr. Gilchrist is Mr. Excitement also.
First guy never brings him down. And, you know, what I like is, although he's small in stature, he knows how to use his size. See, he'll get big over the middle, and then when they try and bring him down, he'll get out of it. He's got a low center of gravity. And then watch him duck underneath the guy right here. See, he's willing to duck underneath, so that's knowing how to use your size to your advantage rather than letting your height become a disadvantage.
First and goal at the one. And now we have movement again after that. That was a 21-yard second and 21 play. And they came up with a 30-yard pass play to Jeremy Gilchrist. And now we got a penalty on the offensive line.
False start, 62 offense, 5 yards from the previous spot, remaining first down.
That was Michael Ola, redshirt freshman out of Riverdale High in Riverdale, Georgia. Guilty of the infraction that time. And it'll bring up first and goal from the sixth. Joe Taylor, his team knocking on the door, trying to increase their lead to 21. Van Morgan gets the ball, fumbles the ball, and the Bears, or let's see who has it. Wow, there's a scramble at the middle.
Got it.
It may have been T.J. Mitchell that fell on it. Like you said, he was alert and had the presence of mind, and it's going to bring up a second down. And now a little extracurricular activity there by Gerald Guyton, and the officials are giving him, as they say, down the country.
That's what I was saying. You don't know what goes on in that pile. You just tell everybody grab something. This ball actually was on the ground there. He
popped
hit
up
early.
Yeah, well, he ran into the back of one of his blockers up front, and that's what caused the ball to come loose. See, right there, he hits the back of the
fullback, Latrell Payton.
Yeah.
Yeah, that ball squirted, and actually it was on the foot of one of the Bear defenders, and tough to go get that ball at your ankles. T.J. Mitchell had a great angle and dove right in.
Yeah, there's a timeout on the field, 10:28 to go. Second down and goal for the Pirates, leading 14 to nothing when we come back.
Maybe your car is trying to tell you something. Maybe it's asking for the hard-working gasoline at Phillips 66, gas specially formulated to help clean fuel injectors in 5 tanks, which helps you maximize mileage and reduce emissions. Give your car what it's asking for. Give it Phillips 66. Hard-working gas.
With 2 million vehicle listings to choose from on Cars.com, you can find the right car for you.
That's it.
Find the right car for you. Cars.com.
Now, get big arms, a ripped chest, and cut abs with the perfect push-up. The perfect push-up works with the natural rotation of your arms and shoulders to maximize results and minimize stress on your body. With the perfect push-up, your hands, arms, and shoulders rotate 90 degrees, just like in a punch. All the energy of a push-up is captured and transmitted right where you want it, to the muscles. There's no wasted effort, just muscle-building movement. And as your arms rotate, you feel it work in your biceps, your triceps, your chest and abs, and your shoulders. Invented by a U.S. Navy SEAL and made with steel and a ball-bearing movement, it's the push-up perfected. So here's the deal. The perfect push-up is only two payments of $19.95. When you order, you'll receive two perfect push-up rotational handles, and you'll also receive the Navy SEAL-inspired perfect push-up workout chart. You'll be ripped in no time. Get big fast. Call right now for the perfect push-up.
Call 1-800-543-0427.
14 to nothing, 10:28 to go here in the second quarter. Don't forget, you can see the future stars of football today. ESPNU delivers the Old Spice High School Showcase Friday. It's a Louisiana State matchup as McDonough 35 takes on St. Aug out of New Orleans. The Old Spice High School Showcase presented by the U.S. Marine Corps and ESPNU Friday night at 8 p.m. Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com, along with Jay Walker, Charlie Neal, and second down and goal facing the Pirates of Hampton University. Empty backfield now for T.J. Mitchell. Throws it up in the end zone, and this is going to be nobody's ball. Nobody's ball. You know, one of the things you've noticed about just about every play that Hampton runs, they put a man in motion. And Joe Taylor said he likes to put a man in motion because once the offense comes out and gets set, the defense kind of sets itself. But when you put a man in motion, he says motion causes emotion on the part of the defense. That's the words he likes to use.
It makes you think. You know, makes you think. And even in the passing game, they rarely call a play without motion a guy to try and help the quarterback see if it's man-to-man or zone coverage. So they're going to move somebody out right now, see what you're going to do, get out there, get set, then they can see the coverage, and it's easy to
whoa,
see.
Whoa, what a blitz. And that was dangerous for being almost intercepted as the defense was coming with a vengeance. Brian Wilson, the defensive end, senior out of Temple Hills, Maryland, he was coming.
See, that's what happens when you motion your blocker out of the play, out of the pass protection. They decide to bring six. You only have five to protect him. Whack! That's what happens. Lights out. That ball could have easily been intercepted.
So a 26-yard field goal attempt This time by Tuavani, freshman out of Niagara Falls, Ontario. Missed one earlier. Now flag goes down. We may have a movement in the line offensively. That one would have been good, but it's going to probably be moved 5 yards further back.
Prior to the snap, false start, 88 blue, 5 yards from the previous spot, remain fourth down.
And that is Marcus Wiggs, this redshirt sophomore tight end who moved. So now it's going to be a 31-yard field goal attempt. The longest attempt that Turvani has had this year was 28 before this game, and he attempted a 36-yarder their last possession, and it went wide left.
You know, down here at Hampton, they're used to making field goals.
No question. With Andrew Paterini,
he was there. And best kicker in the conference for 3 or 4 years, and wore number 37 as well. Mm-hmm. So they expect to make field goals here. This is not your typical college program.
This one is up as the distance, and this one is good. So whether it's a 31-yarder or 26-yarder, Mr. Turavani says, hey, let's put it through the uprights. And quite a story. You talk about him the first game against Howard University. Coach Taylor was in position to kick a field goal. He looked over and he said to Carlo, he said, are you ready? He says, no, coach, I'm not ready. I asked him about that yesterday. He said something was bothering him in his eye.
Yeah,
I think it was fear.
I think it was fear.
It was his first college attempt at a field goal.
You know, your first game and you're playing in that storied Hampton Howard one-sided relationship that some people call a rivalry. I call it a one-sided relationship. A packed house opening day and extremely hot there. So can't blame the kid for getting a little stage fright, but he's gonna have to learn to get over it. This is a big-time college football program, and he's gonna be called upon to make some pressure kicks, especially if the Pirates are gonna get to that elusive second round of the playoffs that they've been trying to get to so bad, and it's been unfortunate.
Yeah, they lost to Richmond. You know, when you talk about last year, they lost to
New Hampshire,
and they had also lost to William and Mary, and they lost to Richmond. They lost to Youngstown State. They lost to UConn. That was back in the 90s.
I mean, the tough part is, you know, for such a great team, they and all this talent, they got guys going to the National Football League. You know, that's what burns Coach Taylor. When you talk to him, you say, hey, what motivates you? I got to get to the playoffs, and I want to win it big. And, you know, he brings in motivational speakers. He brought in Coach Jim Caldwell from the Indianapolis Colts
to talk to the team this year. Right.
Because,
I mean, this is what they did. One-double-A playoffs 2 years. That was with Montrell Coley, Youngstown State, and UConn. And then the last 3 years, you see what they did. Simpson at the 12-yard line, coming back to the middle of the field. That is not Simpson. That's Devin James on the return.
You know, when you look at this list of the playoffs and the losses they have, you know, my team went to the playoffs and I was at Howard. We lost to Marshall. You know, Marshall went on and played in the championship game. The teams that Hampton has lost to have not gone on to win a championship or make it to the final game. So that's the part that really upsets you. Youngstown State actually got to the championship.
Right.
That was in 97. But the rest of these teams lost in the next round or even the semis. So that'll really get you going. You have to press yourself, because if they get past the first round, they're going to be tough to beat. Right now, I think it's more of a mental hurdle than it is a physical hurdle.
And here's Simpson on the carry to the right side. And Simpson still manages to turn the corner before Kendall Lankford made the stop defensively.
Yeah, I'm really impressed with Kendall Lankford. You know, actually, you talk about Kendall Lankford and Marcus Dixon. Both these guys walk around at 6'5", 6'6", 300 pounds, and they look like they play forward on the basketball team.
Yeah, they do.
I mean, neither one of them look like their defensive end. You see them just shielding off blockers and watch them run down the sideline. See, get down the sideline. Once you get beat, get down the sideline and stretch.
I'm sure Coach Nickelberry on the basketball side would like to have these guys.
Do some recruiting. Yeah, they'll get some rebounds for you, too.
And
there he is again.
And the ball comes loose. And it was Lankford. And fortunately for the Bears, they were able to recover it. But Kendall Lankford right there, the man on the spot to make the stop of the quarterback, Mario Melton.
When you talk about playing football on Sundays in the trenches, they're going to measure your motor. So watch Melton get by him. He's by him, and yet Kendall Lankford does not give up on the play, was committed to chasing the quarterback downfield 50 yards if he had to, and makes the big hit on the quarterback to cause the fumble and almost create a turnover.
Simpson with 37 yards rushing in the ball game so far, and here's play action. Melton standing in there. He's going to run it again, turns the corner, and goes out of bounds in front of the Morgan bench and picks up the first down. just shy of the midfield stripe, or let's see where they mark it. They're going to mark it across midfield at the 49 of Hampton University. But we were talking about Chad Simpson. You know, he came into the game needing 27 yards to break into the top 10 in all-time rushers at Morgan State University, and he is 10 yards over that mark tonight with 37.
He's a good one. I mean, transfer guy there. You know, that just tells you that transfers is where it's at. And if you're playing at one of these big 1A schools and you're not on the field, come down to 1AA and make a difference, and the NFL's going to see it. Because trust me, the NFL, they've got their eyes on him, and if he runs well with that stop clock like you know he is, you're talking about NFL draft pick.
No question. I mean, he's a hard runner. He's a tough runner. Who does he remind you of? Well, let's talk about that when we come back. Let's go to the studio in Lowell Galindo.
Yeah, guys, we saw Greg Cooper punch it in for Miami. Now, here is Javaris James taking it right up the middle, bruising in for the score. Miami leading the Aggies 14-0.
Javaris James, 219 yards, 5.3 yards per carry, coming into tonight's ball game for Miami.
Looks like they're going to keep it going, too. Yeah. Hell yeah. Down in that bowl. That's what they call it, in the bowl. Tough to beat.
Second down and 9. Pass caught. First down. Down inside the 35 to the 33-yard line, and it's Surratt on the reception. Stopped by Sam Pope.
Good job by Melton to buy some time with his feet, but you have to wonder, is he leaving the pocket a little too soon? See, he's out there getting out of there, running outside, but he kept his vision downfield, so you can't fault him for that. But
well, you know, with the pressure from the Twin Towers, it may not be a bad idea to get him sprinting out away from that pressure.
A little rollout, but that wasn't a call rollout. That was more Melton kind of looking at the rush getting out of there. He's got to let him know, this is my pocket. I'm not going anywhere. I don't care how many times you hit.
Here's Simpson trying to go left. Simpson still on his feet. Somehow doesn't get hit. Well, it doesn't go down. He lost a couple yards, but, you know, he has great vision, but great defensive pressure by Hampton University.
He's looking for a lane right there. You see penetration in the backfield on the stretch. They're just stretching him out. They're stretching him out. You've got number 58 there. Then you've got number 10 there, the cornerback Pat Preston there. So what they did is they just kept stretching him and stretching him and stretching him, where he ran out of real estate sideways and the sideline made the tackle.
Justin Holland started that stretch move for the defense, number 56 for the Pirates of Hampton University. Here's Melton under pressure, and he has it complete to Jai Wilson, and Jai Wilson falls down but gets the ball down at about the 30-yard line, and it still will bring up a third down. We'll call it 6.
And that's one of those plays where if you make an accurate throw, that's a touchdown. Get excited when the blitz is coming and you see it coming. But Mel gets so excited, he throws his ball so hard, Wilson has to go down and get it. If he catches that ball, he can get by that safety.
He's got some running. Yeah.
And that's a touchdown. That's the difference between a good passing attack that's dangerous and a passing attack that's struggling to find its identity.
Tobin Lyon was the man that was trying to cover, and he would have beaten him easily.
Easily. Safety on the wide receiver, I'll take the wide receiver anytime.
Jai Wilson going in motion. There's a little swing back pass. This is going to be shy of a first down. They get it complete again. And this time Surratt on the reception, but they're going to be shy of a first down. It's going to bring them fourth down. Let's see what the Bears do now. They're down 17-0. And in fourth down situations this year, they're 2 of 3, 67%, tied for number 1 in the MEAC in that department. But I think they're going to go for the field goal this time. This will be a 42-yard, make it a 42-yard field goal attempt. And this will be Meade. He kicks it. He has the distance. And it is good. So James Meade puts the Bears on the scoreboard with 6:39 to go with a 43-yard field goal. That equals his longest of the year. And he's a junior out of Upper Marlboro, Maryland. So the Bears are no longer shut out.
State Farm is proud to sponsor the Mideastern Athletic Conference. Call your local State Farm agent today.
Sometimes when you're together, you just can't stand the idea of being apart. Because when you get into a Volkswagen, it gets into you.
Now through October 1st, get a 2008 Jetta 2.5 liter S for just $197 per month.
Could you turn that TV down, please?
Do you sometimes disturb others when you watch TV?
Now there's Listen Up, the personal sound amplifier that lets you turn the volume up for yourself without turning the volume up for everyone else.
It turns ordinary hearing into extraordinary hearing. Look, it's smaller than a credit card, yet so powerful, you can hear a pin drop from across the room or listen in on a conversation from across the street.
Have you met the new neighbors?
I haven't.
I met him. He seems nice.
Just insert the earphones and adjust the volume. It's that easy. Listen Up is perfect for lectures, movies, shows, or even church. And it's a great way to keep an ear on the children when they're out of range.
Hey, wait for me!
Other sound amplifiers sell for up to $100. But for a limited time, you can get Listen Up direct from the manufacturer for only $14.99.
To order Listen Up, call 1-800-354-9603. That's 1-800-354-9603. Don't delay. Call now.
Years of coaching, Joe Taylor's seen a lot of people come and go, players, assistant coaches, and the Morgan State Bears coaching staff, who had some association with Joe Taylor. Donahill Ealy was a quarterback for him at Virginia Union, plus was the offensive coordinator for him here at Hampton University. Herb Parham also played at Virginia Union and coached here as an assistant head coach. Alonzo Lee played at Western Illinois. Joe Taylor was an assistant coach at Western Illinois, started his coaching career there, and Alonzo Lee played for him there. And of course you have Carl Smith, who's a defensive backs coach. He was an assistant here at Hampton. Of Kerry Gibson, Dixon rather, who was a quarterback here at Hampton University, is now on the staff of Donahill Ealy at Morgan State. So there is a connection there.
Yeah, that's what happens when you got great coaching staff. Sooner or later, somebody's gonna come and pluck your talent pool. And you see it all the time in the NFL with the three shades of Bill Parcells. Well, we got the 5 degrees of separation here in the MEAC Conference with Joe Taylor.
Kevin Teal on the kickoff return. And he brings it all the way back to about the 36-yard line, make it the 38. That's where they're gonna spot the ball. And Hampton University gets the ball. They scored their last time down the field on a 31-yard field goal after getting the ball on an interception by Joaquin Good at the 45-yard line of Hampton. But the defense of Morgan stiffened. And, of course, we talked about this defense being one of the top defenses in the MEAC, and you can see why.
And I think they got some rest, so it's a new ball game now. Right now, if they can get a three and out, get their offense the ball back, they can really get themselves back in this football game from the defensive side of the ball.
T.J. Mitchell.
Got it.
There you go. And it's intercepted this time. And now lateral and coming up the field with it on the defensive side for the Bears of Morgan State is McCon. And McCon fumbles. And now the
Pirates got it.
Pirates of Hampton get it back.
But you know what? The Bears should have this football because he intercepted that ball and took a knee.
It went down.
Yes, and
that's
the official should have whistled that right away. There should have been no more play. It was a great job with the interception. They should have actually blown the whistle. You see him drop to the flat, look up the wide. Right there, he's down. I mean, play's over. Morgan State ball. They should have blown the whistle. And then trying to do too much, that's what the DBs do. They like to showboat, and defensive players like to showboat. That's just what they do. And the fumble, great job there by Kevin Teal, stripping the football, and Hampton came down with that ball. But wow. How do you not call a college player down when he touches the ball?
Well, I thought he went down. And, they missed it. They missed that, like you said. It should still be Hampton's ball.
I was surprised I didn't hear whistles blowing.
First and 10 at their own 27. Keeping it on the ground, and a helmet comes loose.
So right now, this Morgan State defense is fired up, and you know, take
a
look.
His knee down.
Clearly. Clearly. He used his hand to hold him up. He was down, and once again, Morgan State not getting a break here. And actually, when he lateraled that ball, that knee might have been down the second time.
Yeah, so that was Nkrumah who came up with the interception. He lateraled it off to McCon, and of course, this is the second play in this game where instant replay would have
made a difference.
It is second down and 10 for the Hampton Pirates. TJ standing in there, rolling out to his right, now throws, and this one is incomplete.
Good job of timing
Gilchrist,
up the hit.
Yeah, Gilchrist, the intended receiver. And again, it's Chris Williams there defending number six.
From the safety position, and that's what you want to do. If you're a safety and a guy's running a curl route right in front of your face, just run through him. Don't look for the football. Just run through him and try and separate the wide receiver from the football with the big hit from the back.
Chris Williams, one of those young men out of Miami, Carroll High, Florida connection. 18 all total on this Bear football team. 13 from Miami, 8 of them transferred. T.J. Mitchell in trouble. Almost intercepted that time. It was in the hands of Gerald Guyton. He just couldn't hold on.
Yeah, he's got to hold on to that one there. I mean, they're doing a good job. I told you the defense was going to get into the game and try and help jumpstart the offense. And you see Jarrell Guyton here. Once again, T.J. Mitchell staring down his receiver. Guyton just looking at his eyes. Where are you taking me? Where are you taking me? Oh, I got it. Oh, just missed it. I don't blame you, son. That's why you play defense and not offense. You can't catch.
Another one of those Miami connection kids on this Morgan State team. That'll bring on Jamal Blanchard to punt it away. Jai Wilson, the deep man to receive it. Boy, what a kick this time by Blanchard.
Low trajectory, though. This is returnable.
Makes a move to the outside, but he spun right into the Hampton defender. James Butts was one of them, and the other one was Maurice Riley. Don't forget what's coming up at halftime. Let's head back to Lowell Galindo in the studio, and he'll tell us what he's going to be having for us at halftime on SportsCenterU.
Well, guys, Lowell. Texas A&M is getting roughed up on the road in Miami. We'll give you the highlights. And also, Georgia Tech versus Virginia will get you set for that ACC showdown. And Donald Hunt will join us to talk HBCU football. It's coming up at the SportsCenterU Halftime Reports.
Well, that one loss by Miami was to a fifth-ranked team. Oklahoma was ranked fifth at the time, and it'll be interesting to see if they hold on here. And this one is intercepted, picked off by Tobin Lyon on the far side. So the second straight turnover by the Bears of Morgan State. They have three in the ballgame.
And that demoralizes the defense. The defense made a great three and out, had an interception. Now they got to go right back on the floor. Watch what throw off his back leg. Throwing that ball off your back leg, unless you're Brett Favre, don't do it. Bad things are going to happen. And Melton released that ball off his back leg, lost velocity, and Toby Lyon stepped right in for the easy interception.
So Joe Taylor's team, again, in great field position with the ball at the 30-yard line of the Bears of Morgan State.
Now, if you're on defense, you got to get aggressive with your play call and look for defensive coordinator Alonzo Lee to try and bring some extra pressure to try and create a turnover to get time some out. Loss of yards.
Hampton University. Hampton decided to call a timeout. They just didn't have the right personnel or the right plays in place. And Kevin Teal quickly called a timeout. And don't forget, college football continues on Saturday right here on ESPNU with two more games, both of them coming from the ACC. It kicks off at noon Eastern. It's Georgia Tech taking on Virginia. Then at 3:30 p.m. Eastern, Maryland, the Terps, square off against Wake Forest. Saturday afternoon college football presented by Allstate on ESPNU. For more, log on to ESPNU.com, your home for the finest in college sports. Along with Jay Walker, Charlie Neal here, 5:08 to go in the first half. Preseason ranked number 2. That is the Pirates of Hampton University. The Bears are ranked 6th in the preseason polls. In fact, you know, you talk about Donald Hill Ealy. He just got a 2-year extension on his contract. So there's two coaches in this conference that just will reward it for their efforts. Of course, over Norfolk State.
Across the bay. Fumble.
Right down the street. And we got a fumble, and now the Bears get it back. So this is a game of giveaway here the last three possessions.
We knew that Coach Lee was going to get aggressive down here in the play call. And offense just gave the ball up. Defense getting tired. Can't keep them on the field that long. We just bring pressure. Bring pressure from everywhere we can. You see the defensive lineman just beat them in the backfield and Bear defenders all over the ball. And that's just a great individual effort there by the defensive tackle, Anthony Young.
So from their own 35-yard line now, with 5:03 to go in the half, the Bears of Morgan State, who dodged a couple bullets here the last couple times, they dropped the sure interception earlier.
Call a screen. Call a screen to Chad Simpson. Let him get the ball in space. You,
that would be. That might be something to see.
I mean, you know, call
I
it twice.
I pay for that one.
Yeah, call it twice. I will let him touch the ball as many times as I could on this possession because he's clearly the best player on the field when he's there.
Jai Wilson, the man in motion. It goes to Chad Simpson, cuts it back, still on his feet. But I tell you, it takes three people to bring him down. He doesn't go down with just one hit. Believe me.
And all great running backs have that balance.
Charles Robinson was the first one to hit him. He spun off of him, and he, you know, kept going. And finally, Jamari Jones brought him down, but he had to have some help. Second down and 10. New quarterback in there, Byron Selby. And Selby decides he's going to take off and run. And he's run out of bounds in front of the Hampton University bench. And it was Pope who made the hit on him. Number 8.
And there was no doubt when Selby got that pocket, he dropped back, held it for a second. You knew he was going to take off running.
I mean, well, you say he holds it too long, so he's not going to hold it long.
He was looking at the rush. Yeah, he was looking at the rush and was looking for a crease that he can run in. You know, one thing about Selby, give him credit. Coach Hill and staff have said, hey, he lost his starting job, but he hasn't been a cancer on the team.
No,
he's always
hasn't.
Competing. He's going about his business, going to class on time, and trying to help out the new starting quarterback, Mario Melvin, as much as he can.
13, there's some open running room for him right now, and he has a first down across midfield to the 48-yard line of the Pirates of Hampton University before Charles Robinson, the linebacker, drug him down from behind, number 58.
And Selby saying, hey, I got a simple read. I can't read coverages. 1-2, I'm out. So he finds a little gap in the offensive line, and he shows he's an athlete as well with some versatility. Actually, I like that. Delivered the boom on Tobin Lyon, the free safety. Lyon's going to get joked on by his teammates when they watch film on Monday.
Here's a pass in the middle of the field. Here's Jai Wilson with it, and Jai has another first down before Von Mansfield made the stop defensively for the Pirates of Hampton. So now the Bears starting to move the football with 4:04 to go, the clock continuing to run. Now Selby, who threw, as far as a career is concerned, 13 touchdowns and 14 interceptions, has his team on the move. This drive, remember, started at their own 35. They're down to the 37 of the Pirates of Hampton. Now here's an option for the quarterback, and he gets inside the 35 to about the 33-yard line before Jamari Jones made the stop, number 54.
Yeah, 4-yard gain there. You know, what you'll see is first down, take some positive yardage. What Selby's coming here doing, I think the reason that Coach Hill decided to go back with Selby is he didn't think Selby would turn the ball over. You know, Mario Melt was showing he would turn the ball over. Selby may not complete many passes, but he won't turn the ball over, and he's a running threat more than Mario Melton is.
From the shotgun this time. Now he's going to stand in there. Now he's going to take off and run. And he's still on his feet. Delivers a little blow to Pope, but he picks up the first down again, down to the 23-yard line.
You know, as we look at the replay here, he's protecting that football a little bit too loosely, but I like the idea. He's looking for a crease to run, and look at the stiff arm. It's not Darian McFadden here, and that ball is loose. That's not a good Darian McFadden stiff arm, but it got the job done.
So on first down and 10, the ball at the 23 of the Pirates of Hampton University. Bears on the move. Surratt in motion. Now he's going to take off. Looks like an option to the right. Cuts it upfield. Still on his feet. And picks up another first down inside the 15 to the 13. So what do you think about what's going on here?
I think that right now, the defensive coordinator for Hampton University, Jerry Holmes, is not accounting for the quarterback in the running game. And he's being so stubborn, he doesn't want to load the box with an extra defender, thinking that sooner or later that the defensive line is going to make a play. But right now, that's not happening. Byron Selby's just picking a crease, and he's attacking.
And Chinnis Berry, the offensive coordinator of Morgan, seeing they're not loading the box, taking advantage of it. Wilson in motion. This time, the handoff to Simpson. And Simpson dragging people for about 3 yards down to the 10-yard line.
Good, tough running.
Marcus Dixon on the stop defensively. Also, just Jamari Jones. Here's Chad Simpson. 186 rushing yards per game. Had a big game last couple of weeks. 142 in their season opener, 195 in their second game, and 221 last week.
Look for the option here. I like to see Selby probably run an option here in a two-man game with he and Simpson. There it is.
Here's the pitch to Simpson, and Simpson trying to turn the corner. Not a lot of running room over there. Langford is there defensively. Also, Jackie Bates was there to make the stop for the Pirates.
Yeah, great play call there. Only thing I would do differently is, you know, I always thought it was
wide side of the field.
Wide side of the field. Run that option to the wide side of the field where if I've got to stretch it, I can. But, hey, they still picked up 5 yards on this quick dive. See, right off the end man on the line of scrimmage, you know, you give Simpson the ball in space, he knows how to turn the corner and run forward.
So it'll be a second down and 5 for the Morgan State Bears. Knocking on the door, the ball at the 6-yard line. And he tripped, but here's Simpson turning the corner. He's
wow.
in. 6 points for the Bears. Their first touchdown of the night. Simpson with a 6-yard run. And for Chad Simpson, that is his 6th rushing touchdown this year.
We talk about Gilchrist and Teal knowing how to make themselves small in the hole. Watch Chad Simpson disappear here. He knows two backers are going to come and try and hit him at once. So what do? Get low. Right between the two of them for the touchdown. And actually, you know what? He was just too fast for him. He got there quicker than they thought he would.
65-yard drive, and here for the point after. And this one is good. 1:39 remaining in the first half of play here. And what an impressive drive as the Bears take advantage of a fumble, and they take it in and put 6-7 more points on the board, and this is a 7-point ball game, 17-10. Chad Simpson with the rushing touchdown.
That's one of those things where if the speed is something that you're not used to seeing, you got Pirate defenders hitting each other. What a good job there by the Morgan State offense, answering the call led by the quarterback, Byron Selby. That's what you want when you have that senior quarterback as your backup that's been in close games and been in all your battles before. You like to see him come in there and give you a spark, and this spark was simple. I'm gonna run the football, and he ran the ball very effectively. And if you're Coach Hill Ely, the key thing now is be careful on this kickoff and make sure you don't allow Hampton to score any more points in this last 1:39, because with the new clock and the rules change going back to the old clock in college football, 1:39 is plenty of time to run a 2-minute offense in the college game.
No question. McPherson on the near side, Kevin Teal on the far side, back to receive the kick of Jonathan Skeet, a junior out of Ghana, Ohio. Transfer out of Ohio State. Another one of those Division I transfers we were talking about. Each team has 8 Division I transfers on their squad. This will be Teal at the 10-yard line. And Teal coming up the field and brought down right at the 31-yard line. And it was Greg Howard there to make the stop for the special teams of the Bears of Morgan State, number 55.
And that's always a great start. You had a short kick, good special teams play. Defense is playing well. Interesting here, because we know from history that offensive coordinator Corey Sullivan for Hampton, he likes to get aggressive. You know, he doesn't believe in taking a knee going into the half. He tries to score every time he has the ball. Can that Morgan State defense hold on one more time before they can get in the locker room and get some good old-fashioned oxygen?
You were talking about offensive coordinators. Corey's the 3rd offensive coordinator that the Pirates have had at Hampton in the last 3 years. Fred Kice was here a couple of years ago, was down at Tennessee State. And, of course, as Chris Beattie is coaching Division I or the World Championship subdivision group. And now Corey Sullivan comes in. Here's a pass almost picked off, a little low.
Whoa, a little low for the middle linebacker.
Yeah, it certainly was.
A little low for Lamar West. He should have had that interception then.
But you're talking about Corey Sullivan. Kind of interesting story there is after Chris Beattie left, he was looking to hire an offensive coordinator. And, you know, he was interviewing a bunch of people. And he said the players came into him one day and said, hey, why don't we give Corey Sullivan a chance? Corey had been the receivers coach here for the last couple of years. And he said, if the players feel that good about you, I'm willing to give him a chance.
It's a little bit of politics about a wide receiver core, too. If we get our wide receiver coach to be the OC, we're going to get more balls thrown our way.
T.J. Mitchell in trouble. and still on his feet, causing people to miss and finally brought down. And the man on the stop was Brian Wilson, number 41.
TJ showing he's got some athleticism too, Brian Selby, Byron Selby. You're not the only quarterback here that can run. We don't often give TJ credit for his mobility because he's got such a strong arm, but he looked good there.
Well, you know what Joe Taylor likes to say, players make plays, plays don't make players. Under a minute to go. TJ on a third down situation. That almost a lateral. Actually goes incomplete. It's a pass. And it'll bring up a fourth down punting situation. Fourth and eight for the Pirates with 46 seconds to go. So the Bears of Morgan State, they didn't make the trip from Baltimore 6 hours for nothing, huh?
No.
They came down here to play. They tightened up the chin straps.
They've got that momentum.
They certainly do.
And if you're Coach Taylor, it's the second week in a row that your team has not closed out the first half well. We saw that last week against North Carolina A&T.
But then Kevin Teal came out the second half. Blew it wide open.
But Morgan actually still has a chance to get a return and still get some points on the board.
All right, snap. Blanchard will get it down. Great kick.
What a kick.
Boy, he's kicking it well, isn't he? Guy Wilson all the way down inside the 10, back at the 8-yard line, and he is going to be brought down at about the 21. Let's look at Morgan State on the last drive. They're doing it basically by way of the ground attack.
Yeah, Byron Selby came in and decided, hey, I'm going to run the football. I'm not having a great day throwing the ball, running a little pitch option here, decided to call his own number once you get closer to the goal line, and then Chad Simpson. We knew sooner or later this great running back was going to explode and do something exciting. And that was it right there to give the Bears their first touchdown of the ball game.
So the Bears have scored their last two possessions, a 43-yard field goal and a touchdown. And they trail it by 7, and they have the ball with 35 seconds to go. Let's see what Chenis Berry comes up with in terms of offensive production here. They can try to get some points on the board. Here's the quarterback trying to keep it again as Byron Selby. They may be satisfied to just go into the locker room down 7 points.
I think so. And it was such a great punt.
It was.
If it had been a bad punt,
you know, you got a chance to at least get in the field goal range. But now, you know, unlike the pros, it's you're not going to get a 50-yard field goal.
No, you're not going to do it. Blanchard is a weapon, actually, for Hampton because he's got great kickoffs and great punts, so that'll neutralize the drive.
Well, he side-armed that to Jai Wilson, and Jai Wilson takes it across the 40 to the 41-yard line, and they call a timeout with 20 seconds to go as Jackie Bates made the stop for the Pirates of Hampton.
And I like this.
Oh, make that 2 seconds. I'm sorry. It's 2.0 on the clock. I thought it was 20. 0-2.0.
Oh, yeah, that's what Coach Hill wishes he had after that last completion there, but this is the case where you sit there and you get your quarterback with the strongest arm in the ball game, and when I played fortunate enough, that was me. So I get in there and throw a 60-yard Hail Mary.
And nobody ever caught it.
Hey.
Log on to your online source for all things college sports, ESPNU.com. It's an online service that's a gateway to all college sports content from ESPN. We have tons of highlights and exclusive material, including news, podcasts, live streaming games, and much, much more. Just log on to ESPNU.com today because we are college sports.
What's the key thing a quarterback has to do on a Hail Mary type situation?
Not get sacked.
So when you're dropping back, unlike other past opportunities, you're looking at the line. Don't let them get too close. If you got to leave that pocket early, leave. Because if that defense gets to you, they're going to try and force a fumble.
They just throw it off in the middle of the field. And Chad Simpson figured, well, this guy, he dances very good. And maybe he could outdance some of the defense there as Justin Holland made sure. As they go into the locker room, though, the Bears of Morgan State starting to roar a little bit and giving the Pirates a couple of headaches. Mr. Chad Simpson, the man who's had over 150 yards in every game so far this season, his team trailing by 7. 17-10 here. Let's go back to the studio in Lowell Galindo.
Welcome to the Sports Center U Halftime Report. I'm Lowell Galindo with Steve Israel and the pride of Converse Judson High School, Derwin Gray. Do you realize what that means, Judson High School, Izzy?
I have no idea.
That is to Texas high school football what USC is to college football in California.
It's that big.
That's what it is. Duren, great for you to be here with us on the Halftime Report. Let's talk about this game. Hampton is up 17-10. What is standing out about Hampton, the Pirates, in the first half of this game?
Well, first of all, Morgan State is not buying the fact that Hampton is a three-time defending MEAC champion. It's not buying into the fact that Hampton has Langford and Mitchell. What they're doing is they're coming out and they're playing ball and saying, you know what, we want to win. This is the opening MEAC game, and they want to make a statement that they can come into the defending champion's house and win. And they're doing a heck of a job.
Steve, how do you think Morgan State's looking at this point?
Well, Byron Selvey said, you know what? I know Hampton is going to be keen on our big-time back, Chad Simpson. I need to take onus on myself and help out with this running game, and that's exactly what he's done. He's called his own number on several quarterback draws, on several options. He decided to keep the ball, and because of that combination, helping Chad Simpson out in the running game, they're still in it, along with those turnovers.
17-10, Hampton leading Morgan State at halftime. Coming up next, we're going to talk about two teams that love playing on Thursday night, Texas A&M and Miami. We'll tell you why and bring you the highlights coming up after the break on the U.
McDonough versus St. Augustine, Friday at 8 p.m. on ESPN.
As we get ready to start the second half here at Armstrong Stadium in Hampton, Virginia, the Pirates, the three-time defending MEAC champs and ranked number 12 in the championship subdivision, leading the Bears of Morgan State 17-10. And, you know, you heard the guys in the studio talking about Kendall Langford and what he's been, that Julius Peppers comment. What do you think?
I mean, hey, not far off. I mean, physically, he's got it there. Does he have the motor of a Julius Peppers? That's the question everybody wants to know. Yeah. But physically gifted, he walks around at 300 pounds, and he looks like he weighs 250 pounds.
But, of course, the Morgan State Bears, they started to roar as the first half came to end. But here's the beginning of the game, and this is a great catch by a defensive end.
Marcus Dixon, the other half of that defensive twin towers for Hampton with the Hail Mary catch. And then you look later, you saw Jeremy Gilchrist. We talked about in the open, if he catches his ball in space, he's one of the most explosive wide receivers in the country. He did not let us down, getting pay dirt on the big touchdown for Hampton. They didn't stop there. Fumble there. The Morgan State defense woke up, got into this game, to lead to this touchdown by their Mr. Everybody's All-American, Chad Simpson, for the 5-yard plunge to give us a 17-10 game at halftime.
Yeah, let's look at some of the first half stats, and you look at the rushing yards for the Bears of Morgan State. They've actually outrushed the Pirates of Hampton 117-86, but in the passing yards, Hampton has the edge there. But when you look at the plays, one team ran 37, the other ran 35. So they're pretty even in terms of output in this ball game so far. You've got three turnovers by Hampton.
I'm really impressed with this Morgan State defense. I mean, they gave their offense the ball back early in this contest with great field position. They created turnovers. They did what they were supposed to do. They actually limited Hampton to 17 points. That seems like an oxymoron saying they limited them to 17 points, but they did a great job considering the tough positions that their offense put them into.
Certainly did. And they've done a great job so far tonight. Devin James on the carry on the second half kickoff, and Morgan gets the ball to start the second half. And they'll start at their own 36-yard line. First down and 10, trailing by 7 points in the game. Let's see what they do. You know, we talk about first drive in a game this year. Morgan State was in great position to put some points on the board for the first time on their first drive this year, but they missed on a 44-yard field goal, because in previous first drives in their previous three games, they punted the ball twice, and then they threw an interception. So they did drive down the field and had good field position, but was unable to come away with any points. Right now, Simmons, the man in motion. Here's Simpson going straight ahead, and Simpson gets maybe 3 yards on the play up to the 39-yard line.
And I always say that I think the second half, the first opening series, both offensively and defensively, are what separate the great coaches from the average coaches. I mean, a great coach can go in there, make halftime adjustments, motivate his team again for the job they have at task. And Joe Taylor's done a good job of that time and time again. Now I like to see what Coach Hill can do over on the Morgan State side. Did he learn that from his mentor and coaching, Joe Taylor? And can he motivate his team to come out and do some good things and capitalize on opportunities?
And this is a Morgan team that's had only 2 winning seasons since 1973.
And he's responsible for both of them.
He certainly is. And here's Selby turning the corner on the quarterback keeper. And again, he's doing what he did to end the first half. And he's going to bring his team to a a third down and one situation right at about the 45-yard line.
Selby's being very active in the running game there, but he still has to protect that football. If he keeps carrying that football as far away from his body as he is, he's a big kid, 6'3" with a long wingspan like a condor, you got to get that ball close to your body or else the Pirate defense is going to catch heed of what you're doing and knock it out of there.
Brian Selby, seven carries, 47 yards with that last run that he just had in the ball game, and now it's a third down situation for the Bears.
They hurry up and get this playoff.
They're 2 of 7 in third down conversions, and they get it. Here's an option play. Quarterback keeps it, gets across midfield, still on his feet. Selby gets the first down into Hampton territory. So they start out the second half moving the chains.
Yeah, it looks like Morgan has figured out that Hampton doesn't know how to contain the option. I mean, they've got everybody inside. They're getting seal blocks on the outside. Quarterback goes 12 yards downfield before any Pirate defender's even close to him. So keep calling that play until they learn how to stop it. Great job of simplifying the playbook by the Bears.
And the adjustments made on the offensive side of the ball by, like you said, the Morgan State Bears defensively. The Pirates haven't figured out what they're going to do to stop it. Now they go back to a pro set. Simmons in motion. And now they hand off, and he stumbled. That is the running back, Simpson, lost his footing as he got to the line of scrimmage and still managed to pick up a couple yards.
And the fact that they've had success running the football with the option, that's credit to Langford, Dixon, and Bryant. You know, how do you take the big front three out of the game for Hampton University? Well, you don't run straight at them. You run side to side. You double team down and make the safeties and the defensive backs come up and make tackles in the running game.
Second down, roll out to the right
he's gonna
side.
Run again.
And he's going to take off. He doesn't even wait for his blocking.
Oh, that should be a flag.
Looked like he led with a helmet, didn't he?
Yeah, he led with a helmet, and Selby was slowing down there. You know, one thing you want to see, once you get outside that pocket, you know, he could have got this first down. They're going to be third and a yard short. Everybody's dropping. Run. Get aggressive. Tuck that ball in there. Lean forward. Look, he's taking so much time slowing down. I know you saw a plethora of blue jerseys up there, but lower your shoulders and get that first down,
right,
son.
Demarius Sapp was the man who hit him at his third down and one, as you said, Jay, down at the 33 of Hampton. But this is a drive that started at their own 36-yard line. Here's Simpson bouncing to the outside. He will not get the first down as he is wrapped up immediately by Bates.
The reason why he wasn't successful, that was a horrendous job of blocking by Edwin Baptiste on the outside. You've got a bounce play by design. And watch number 84 from Morgan State on your left side. He's just going to get demolished in one-on-one blocking with a cornerback, and that's Sam Pope getting aggressive, playing corner force to break up this play. See, get your body on. You got to know where the ball's going. You know the defender doesn't. Get in between yourself and the ball and don't allow Pope to make that type of force play.
Now, him not getting that first down on the previous play, that second down run is huge, and it'll bring up a fourth down situation. They're going to go for it. First time this night on a 4th-and-3 that they're going to go for it. Quarterback decides he's going to take off and run with it, and looks like he got it.
He stretched out there. We talk about him keeping that ball loose, but at least he knew where the chains were there. He stretched that ball out there and got the first down.
On a fourth down play tonight, the Bears of Morgan State, who in previous games were 2 of 3 in fourth down conversion, 67%. They go for it this time.
I mean, this is funny to me. Was there any doubt he was not going to run this football?
I don't know why he's looking downfield like he was going to throw it to somebody,
just to buy
right?
a little time. And I trust me, Byron Selby will not throw a pass unless that guy is wide open.
And this time, Simpson gets the call, and Simpson goes forward for about 4 or 5 yards.
And that's a tough one. I mean, you know, you can only run the option so many ways, and you can disguise it so many times. You got to try and run the ball up the middle. Morgan tried to bring a pulling guard. They tried to pull Dwayne Delaney there to get an extra body over there on the left side. I mean, really tough to run straight at Hampton. You got to continue to run on the outskirts. And what Hampton's doing in their defense as well, take a look at the cornerbacks. You see number one here? He's not going to give too much cushion. He's getting close on that line of scrimmage to eliminate those little wide receiver screens that Morgan State likes to run.
It was a gain of 2 on the last play, 2nd down and 8. And again, here's the option to the right. This time throws and has it complete on the near sideline to Surratt.
I told you he was only going to throw the ball if the guy was wide open. I mean, if you look at the replay here, you're going to see nobody within 10 yards of Surratt. And actually, had he got the ball to him sooner, Surratt could have cut up field. Look at it. He's looking, looking, looking. I want somebody wide open. No, I'm not going to squeeze that throw. Okay, oh, look. Nobody within 7 yards there, and he delivered the ball.
And there's a first down gain on the completion to Surratt. So it's first and 10, ball at the 19 of the Pirates. They're trying to tie this ball game up. Here's Simmons in motion. Here's a Simpson with the carry, but Simpson is not going to get away from the defensive side of those blue jerseys of the Pirates of Hampton University. The first man to get there was Desmond Stewart. Also had some help down there defensively.
Well, this is one of those times where field gets a little shorter, defenses get to get a little closer in there, so you need your defensive line to step up. You got to be looking for a guy like Kendall Langford to make a big play if you're Hampton and to beat his man one-on-one and disrupt the running game.
Well, they know what Simpson can do, so you see they're keying on him. They lost a yard on that play, but here's Simpson into the secondary, and Simpson breaks it loose for another first down. Just when you thought you had Simpson figured out, as Demaryius Sapp finally saved the touchdown.
Yeah, they had the pulling guard there on the trap there. James Key coming down, and Joaquin Good shot the gap and overran the running play there, allowing the Bears to come up with a big play and a big first down for Chad Simpson and crew.
First and goal at the 9 for the Bears of Morgan State. Option right left to throw. The pass is complete and knocked out of bounds after the reception is Baptiste. Vaughn Mansfield made the stop defensively for the Pirates of Hampton University.
And that's the perfect example of a quarterback that's looking to run first, pass second. You know, had he anticipated that Baptiste was going to be so wide open on his initial break, he'd have got the ball to him sooner.
But yeah,
he was surprised that he was so wide open and had to rush the throw, and it wasn't that accurate. Baptiste ran out of bounds.
A gain of 4 on the last play. Second down and goal at the 5. Looking right. Knocked down. Almost intercepted. And that was Langford coming up with it defensively for the Pirates of Hampton University. Kendall Langford.
Yeah, and that's one of the changes you see in college football. This is a zone blitz. You see Langford not going to let anything get outside of him. He starts off in a three-point stand, showing his agility to bat the ball down in pass coverage. That's been the one thing that's changed college and pro football more than anything, the advent of the zone blitz and the spread offense.
Langford had a 22-yard interception last week that he returned for a touchdown against the Aggies. Here's Simpson. Simpson into the secondary. Touchdown.
He got in.
Touchdown, Morgan State, with 9:14 to go. What an impressive second half drive, a 64-yard drive, and they put points on the board.
You know, if you got a great running back like Chad Simpson, if you can find a quarterback that's not going to hurt you in the passing game and turn it over and just move the chains first down after first down, that was a textbook drive by the Morgan State Bears.
Used about 6 minutes off the clock. More impressively, the point after is up and it is good, and we have a tied ball game in Hampton at Armstrong Stadium. As the fans here might have said, who would have thunk it? But the Bears came to play. Chad Simpson with his second touchdown of the night, this one from 5 yards out. We'll be back.
ESPNU brings you college sports 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The passion, the anticipation, the excitement.
Wide open touchdown!
Every season.
This is for 3. Count it.
Every reason to watch.
And that's gonna do it.
Every sport all year round. Tomorrow night at 7:30, news and analysis on ESPNU Recruiting Insider. At 8, Old Spice High School Showcase, McDonough 35 versus St. Augustine. ESPNU, always in season.
Would you agree that these two products taste similar?
Yes.
Do you think that we, as the Coke brand, would have a case against the Coke Zero brand? Because they've infringed upon our taste.
It's a novel theory. What would your proposed endgame be? What would your...
That they were crushed and Ron, their director, was in the fetal position crying under the copier. Crying.
Da-da-da-da-da-da.
Only the Nissan Titan has a Utilitrack cargo system and the longest crew cab bed in its class. You choose the tie-down points, you choose the angle. Because Nissan thinks, when you put something in your bed, it should stay there. The new 2008 full-size Nissan Titan. The Titan of trucks. Now get up to $3,500 Nissan cash back or 1.9% APR financing.
I used to suffer from acne on my chest and back. The pimples were painful, unsightly, and embarrassing. But then, my dermatologist recommended Pinoxyl Bar Acne Wash. Pinoxyl Bar Acne Wash is a treatment that works two ways. It gently removes excess oil from skin to cleanse and unclog pores, while the benzoyl peroxide medication works to kill the bacteria that cause acne. You too can enjoy healthy, clearer skin with dermatologist recommended Pinoxyl Bar Acne Wash.
Pinoxyl Bar from Stiefel Labs is available at CVS, Rite Aid, and Walgreens.
The Bears of Morgan State have just tied it up, and here's Robinson, who just missed Chad Simpson here going into the end zone.
Perfect defensive call. You got your outside linebacker rushing into the backfield unblocked, but he took a poor angle of pursuit. Chad Simpson made him pay with his second touchdown run of the evening.
So to receive the kickoff, remember, this Bears team was trailing in this ball game 17 to nothing. They've scored 17 unanswered points and have tied it up and used a good portion of the clock here. It was a 14-play, 64-yard drive, 5:16 off the clock.
That doesn't happen often to this Pirate team, giving up 17 unanswered points. Let's see if the Pirates are shell-shocked or if they can gear up for the challenge and match Morgan's intensity.
Kevin Teal will field it right at about the 14-yard line, and he's coming down the left sideline, and he's going to be bounced out of bounds at the 31-yard line. Cameron George there on the special team for the Bears of Morgan State. Of course, the president of Hampton University is Dr. William Harvey, and always good to come down to Armstrong Stadium. Dr. Harvey, how are you?
Well, I'm doing great. We got an exciting ball game here.
I know you're not happy right now. You don't look too happy. You got that 17. You gave up 17 unanswered points.
Well, defense, we really aren't tackling. We're flagging. Probably need to put a spy on the quarterback because they are running that option pretty good. But I'm sure our coaches are going to adjust. But I'll tell you something. It's an exciting ball game. But I must say that the excitement of the football game, as well as the reverie of the moment, we can't forget the fact that the Geno 6 are having difficulty down in Louisiana. And I hope that all of your viewers will understand that and understand that it's very important for us to serve it with a great deal of solidarity with those young people down there.
Well, thank you so much. And, you know, we're talking about this beautiful campus you have here right on the river here in Hampton, Virginia. You broke ground in July for the nation's largest proton cancer treatment center. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, there are only five proton centers in the country, only 15 in the world. Hampton University did break ground in July, and we're looking forward to really easing human misery and saving lives. Proton therapy is a new modality for fighting that dreaded disease of cancer. And I'll give you just one example. One out of three Americans get cancer. But if you think about prostate cancer, black men, for an example, have a 59% higher incident rate of prostate cancer than do white men. So we've got a lot to do, and this modality is going to help in a lot of ways.
And they're also the leading HBCU in science research initiatives.
Yes, in the last 2 years, we have been the leading HBCU in getting federal dollars for science and engineering. That's a tribute to our faculty, though. You know, our faculty members are great researchers. They are the ones that that do the heavy lifting on that. So I'm very proud of them and what they are doing.
Your team is moving the ball right now, but you're talking about moving the ball and having a big game coming up in a couple of weeks. You're going to play Princeton. Talk about the significance of you playing Princeton.
Well, Princeton is an Ivy League school, and with a great deal of excellent academics. Hampton University has a great deal of excellent academics, and yet both institutions have great athletic tradition. So I think that it's going to be terrific for us to be able to go to Princeton this year. In 2 years, they're going to come here. Two great academic institutions with athletic tradition, being able to play one another on a consistent basis, and we think that that's good.
Well, it's always great to see that. Two flying powerhouses of academic excellence going against each other, Hampton University and Princeton. And Dr. Harvey, it's always a pleasure coming down here, and thank you so much for joining us here in the ball game, and we're going to get back to football.
Charlie, thank you so very much.
So there was a penalty. Of course, they moved the ball down the field. That is the Pirates of Hampton University.
You know I like that president. I mean, Dr. Harvey, you have a president talking about maybe we need to get a spy to key the quarterback for Morgan State and wrap up and tackle a little bit more.
See, you don't realize, that, Jay, you don't remember when they were in the CIAA and there was Harrison Wilson, who was the president of Norfolk State, and Dallas Simmons was the president over at Virginia Union when Joe Taylor was coaching over there, and how these guys were so competitive as presidents. And you'd go to the CIAA basketball tournament and see these guys. I mean, they were cheering harder than the fans.
Yeah, like, that's what it is. You know, and you have to care. I mean, the key is everywhere we go, I like seeing presidents that care, because at the end of the day, you know, I'm an African-American man, and we always say, hey, there's an epidemic in terms of lack of black men going to college, yet you get them in a black college environment and the presidents care because they realize the importance of academics and athletics and giving young people an opportunity.
No question about it. So third down and 11 facing the Pirates of Hampton right now. And so far tonight, they're 3 of 9 in third down efficiency. TJ Mitchell trying to get his team back into the lead. And he's going to put it in the air. This one is
good
knocked
defense.
Down. Great defense down the field by George Howard for the Bears of Morgan State.
Well, that was a fantastic job there. I was actually
along with Nkrumah.
Kofi Nkrumah did a
25.
Good job.
I thought it was, yeah.
You know, what they've been doing is attacking the middle of the field. So what does Kofi Nkrumah do, number 25? Watch him. He'll come into your screen late. Just look up the wide receiver, run there, and just get an arm on it. He was out there in the corner, saw the quarterback lock in, and look at that effort. That's a great effort, because the throw was actually put in the right place. He had to stop the wide receiver from running to the safety, and Kofi Nkrumah made a fantastic breakup.
This one goes into the end zone, or will it? No, it's going to go out of bounds. A Coffin corner kick, and it goes out at the 5-yard line. So Jamal Blanchard, who was booming him in the first half, booms another good one and puts Morgan State deep in their own territory. We'll be back.
McDonough versus St. Augustine, Friday at 8 p.m. on ESPNU.
It's a full slate of football only on ESPNU. First at noon, Georgia Tech rambles into Virginia. Then at 3:30, the Terps are in Winston-Salem to battle Wake. And at 7, UConn tackles Pitt. The action begins Saturday at noon, only on ESPNU.
At Hampton University, we're changing the face of the future today. We're using fiber optics to help people with artificial limbs feel again. We are building satellites to help us better predict the weather. We are helping to win the war against breast cancer. At Hampton University, we are preparing students for the new millennium with state-of-the-art technology, cutting-edge academics, and a tradition of leadership for more than 130 years. Hampton University, setting the standard of excellence.
When hot, molten rock, ash, and gases erupt and escape from deep below the surface, it often results in a touchdown. For those who have what it takes on the inside, muscle has what it takes on the outside.
So what does this Jetta have that the Corolla doesn't?
Well, power windows, variable intermittent wipers, four-wheel disc brakes, more horsepower, electromechanical power steering and traction control.
When you get into a Volkswagen,
does it have 6 airbags? Standard?
It gets into you.
Yeah.
Now through October 1st, get a 2008 Jetta 2.5-liter S for just $197 per month.
Who's that other?
6:54 remaining here in the third quarter, all tied at 17 apiece. This may be the best field position that Hampton has had in a long time. They've gotten Morgan State pinned back at their own 5-yard line. And if they can hold them here, they may have great field position as they give off to the running back Devin James, who's trying to come to the right side, and he doesn't. Or is that Simpson on the carry? Chad Simpson? Yes, he's in the lineup. And he only gets back to the line of scrimmage. But, you know, you look at the last five possessions for the Hampton Pirates, three of the last five, they wound up punting the ball, and then they threw an interception and fumbled. So they haven't been very productive since early on in the first half.
I think Morgan got to them. They figured out what they were trying to do offensively and attacking the seams and in the middle of the field. The defense made the adjustments. Hampton's got to be careful. I know they really want to get the safety.
Selby in the end zone. He's got to throw it away.
Wide open.
Throws it out here to the tight end, Simmons. Simmons has a first down, and he's upended, but not before he picks up the first down at the 25. Simmons wide open. It looked like Selby might have been throwing that one away, but a 20-yard gain on that pass play to the tight end, Sean Simmons, out of Houston's Lamar High.
Good poise by Selby, not to panic in the pocket. I mean, most quarterbacks get close, you get rid of it. I actually thought he was going to turn and get a safety in the pocket, but he kept his vision downfield, found a wide-open tight end, Sean Simmons down the sideline, and whoop! Good tackle, form tackle. That's
yeah,
what
that's
you want to do. You know, when you're Jackie Bates, you go 5'10", buck 75. You don't want to hit that tight end coming there with 250-plus.
They say he can run, too. He's about a 4.240 speed guy. Here's Simpson trying to turn the corner, and he's bottled up over there. And actually, he's going to lose maybe a yard on the play. Joaquin Good there defensively for the Hampton Pirates.
And this is one where, you know, you keep feeding Chad, and you just got the feeling he's going to break one sooner or later. I mean, it's been tough running for him. He's had to work for every yard he's gotten, and you see now it looks like he's getting a little cramp in the calf. But if you keep feeding him and he can find a way to stay in this football game, he's got that explosive first step where if he makes one guy miss quick, he can take it the distance.
So Chad Simpson, a little slow in getting up right now. 62 yards, a pair of touchdowns for him so far tonight. Out of Miami's Edison High, he was a young man who started his college career in South Florida, and because of the linebacker Gerald Guyton, who was also a high school teammate, he was all set, you know, to go somewhere else. And you know, Gerald just convinced him to come here to Morgan State. Gerald Guyton was all scheduled to, all set to go to another school also. In fact, he was going to Texas Southern. And there's a dropped open. Dropped it wide open, and that was Simmons, the tight end. He would have had another first down at the 40-yard line.
I mean, this is just frustrating as the offensive coordinator. They've been calling plays all night. You know, when I asked the offensive staff, what's been the problem with the offense? How come you guys are averaging 115 yards, you know, per game? Is it the quarterback missing throws? Well, in the first half, the quarterback was missing. Now in the second half, you see a drop ball right there.
Yeah, he let it go too far to his hands, and it hit his face mask and caromed off.
If they can ever get it going on the all cylinders and find the chemistry, this Morgan State team has some talent.
Third down and 11 for the Bears. Throws out the flat to Wolf. Wolf is going to be brought down shy of the first down marker by about 5 yards at the 30-yard line. So Roderick Wolf on the reception, that'll bring up a fourth down punting situation. But at least Morgan State gave themselves some breathing room. They got their backs from against the wall at the 5-yard line, even though they're going to be punting it from the 30.
Yeah, very rarely do offensive coordinators plan for 95-yard offensive drives. The key is, can you get one first down? Then if you can give me a second one, that's great. We can punt the ball and make the battlefield position competitive again, but they need to get a good punt off here.
They certainly do, because Jeremy Gilchrist can really give Hampton some great. That's a great punt. That is a great punt. And it drives Gilchrist back all the way inside the 25 to the 24. And he's going down the sideline, though, and still brings it back to the 40-yard line. So Jeremy Gilchrist with a good return. And finally, Lonnie Harvey makes the stop for the Bears of Morgan State. 4:29, the time remaining, third quarter.
With 2 million vehicle listings to choose from on Cars.com, you can find the right car for you.
Blue is.
Find the right car for you. Cars.com.
Get your weekly dose of NFL news and analysis from Boomer and the Gang. Sunday NFL Countdown, 11 a.m. on ESPN.
Your Marshall!
In a moment, everything can change.
All players and coaches on board were killed in the greatest disaster in college sports history.
In a moment.
I'm Coach Jack Lingle.
We're in this together now.
Anything is possible.
This is not a game. This is about what happened to this town.
This is your opportunity to rise from these ashes.
We are Marshall. Now available from DirecTV pay-per-view movies.
Breaking news in the gaming world.
The top pro gamers in America are disappearing.
This video just in, recorded at a local tournament. Players are being rounded up, whether they like it or not.
Teams have been assembled. Games have been chosen. Join the country's top gamers as they go team versus team and city against city for a chance to earn millions in the biggest pro gaming challenge in history. The Championship Gaming Series, only on DirecTV.
Morgan State University band made the trip down from Baltimore. Oh, yeah. It's all tied at 17 apiece here in the third quarter. Hampton with the ball, first and 10 at their own 40-yard line. And here's a delayed handoff to Van Morgan. Morgan gets about 4 yards on the play. But you're talking about what they lost defensively, the Bears, you know, this past season. Two of the starters from that 06 team were Darius Leak and Robert Armstrong, and basically everybody else is back, and that's why they're playing so well.
Yeah, when you look at the roster, they had 20 seniors on the roster, 6 starters on offense, 6 starters on defense, and they're actually doing a fantastic job. So if they keep it up, you know, Coach Alonzo Lee deserves plenty of credit. I mean, he can just flat out coach defenses, and one day he will be a head coach in this conference.
And Van Morgan gets the first down. Byron Tate on the stop for Hampton. Number 54.
And the most impressive thing about this Morgan State defense, when you look at a year ago, they were, you know, first in the MEAC in stopping the run. They were last in the MEAC in passing yards per game, giving up 186. In this season, in 2007, they've lowered the run defense. They're only giving up 74 yards per game, and they've gotten better with the pass defense. So the key is, that's very impressive. Coming here, taking on Hampton, team throws for about 200 yards per game, and limiting the big plays. Besides the one we saw from Gilchrist earlier, this defense has been bend but not break, and I think Coach Lee's got to be proud of his unit.
T.J. Mitchell in trouble, lets it go, still gets it complete to Teal, and Teal on his feet and has the first down. Kevin Teal, well, what pressure was put on the quarterback. Darren McCann finally made the stop, but the pressure by Wilson, Brian Wilson.
And this is football. You know, this is just football. You're going for a play-action fake. They don't buy it. You got an athletic quarterback there. Look upfield, find somebody open. You had about half a second to find a wide receiver after getting hit. That's just football. The game of football, you're going to get hit sometime and get dragged down. But T.J. Mitchell had the presence of mind to realize where his wide receiver was open and helping the Pirates get the first down.
At the 34-yard line of Morgan State now, Teal is the man in motion. Here's the snap, and here's the delayed handoff to the running back, Van Morgan. And it's Nkrumah there to make the stop defensively for the Bears of Morgan State. They'll be taking on, in their next contest, the Bears. They'll be traveling down to Daytona Beach. They'll be on the road for the next 2 ball games. This is the first of 3 road games in a row for the Morgan State Bears. They'll be at Bethune next week, and following that, they'll be at A&T, and I think that's Bethune's homecoming. That's kind of an early homecoming, but there's TJ in trouble, and he is sacked. Brought down immediately by Justin Lawrence, number 52.
The nose tackle, and they don't get sacks too often, but it was great team defense. You had the two ends bringing pressure, forcing T.J. Mitchell to step up in the pocket. He actually stepped up into a headache because Justin Lawrence was spying him from the nose tackle position.
And that's the first time that Hampton has been sacked all season long.
I mean, both these teams do a great job of protecting their quarterbacks. And Morgan State's quarterbacks have only been sacked once this year, and Hampton was 0, so now they're equal in the sack department. Great protection schemes by both schools.
Third down and 15 for the Pirates. Morgan in motion. Somebody moved on the offensive line, number 62. The left guard, Michael Ola, left tackle, Michael Ola.
Prior to the snap, false start, 62 offense, 5 yard penalty, remaining third down.
They say pressure does a lot of things. It can bust a pipe, and it can actually get you a little nervous. Previous play, they got pressure. Look at the right side of your screen. He was just toying with him a little bit, and Michael Ola there got caught with a little bit of movement, trying to make sure he got beat on that last play with a hard upfield rush, trying to get out of the stance a little bit too quick.
Hampton 3 of 10 in third down conversions. His third and 20 facing him right now at the 44-yard line. TJ under pressure trying to throw the screen, and it's going to be incomplete.
Yeah, that should be a penalty, too. That was a wide receiver screen, and he threw that ball past the line of scrimmage. You can't do that if the lineman got downfield.
Right. So you're going to have an ineligible man downfield. Good call, Mr. Referee. Jay?
Well, I was going to say, I thought Mr. Jay, I call it. Well, you know, the key, I think Morgan do the right thing, decline the penalty, because if you actually accept it, you're doing Hampton a favor. And
giving him another down.
Yep, and making Jamal Blanchard give him a little bit more room to pin you back.
Ineligible man downfield. Offense, number 69. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
And you could have named a number of people who were downfield on that. Yeah. They just gave it to the center, Justin Gary.
Now let's see if Morgan gets aggressive and goes for the block field goal here. You know, they're probably going to pin you back.
You're
not
going to
get a good return. So go for the block punt here. See if you can get a game breaker.
And they're coming. But Blanchard gets it off. Fair catch called for. Let's see where it dies.
Wow.
It goes into the end zone. They had the right idea. That is the Pirates of Hampton University. James Butts, number two, the freshman, was down there, but it went into the end zone. It'll be brought out to the 20. And don't forget, you can see the future stars of football today as ESPNU delivers the Old Spice High School Showcase. It's Friday, and it's the Louisiana State Showdown. McDonough 35 takes on St. Aug. It's the Old Spice High School Showcase presented by the U.S. Marine Corps on ESPNU Friday night at 8 p.m. Eastern. For more, log on to ESPNU.com.
And that's a great game. Both those schools out of New Orleans, everybody knows what New Orleans went through. And to see McDonough 35 and St. Aug playing football again is great for the city of New Orleans.
Selby passes. This time it's caught by the fullback coming out of the backfield, Cherifant. And Cherifant gets it up to about the 30-yard line, very close to a first down before Jackie Bates made the stop.
Take a look at this punt here. I mean, had they not touched this ball, it would have settled. It was stopping.
Right.
They came and pushed it into the end zone.
Pushed it into the end zone. Actually, the person who actually pushed it in there was Derek McPherson, number seven. This time, the handoff to the running back. Again, Chad Simpson.
Wow. I mean, that was what you call great one-on-one play by Marcus Dixon coming down that right side of the line. One-on-one coverage. His offensive lineman tried to seal block him, and he slid all the way down the line of scrimmage to make that tackle for no gain.
Well, they got the first down. They got two yards. They had to get to the 30, and they got across midfield. So we're under a minute to go here in the third quarter. Still tied at 17 apiece. Morgan has rallied from a 17-0 deficit to come back and tie this ball game. And here's Selby going back to the air, letting it go. Long pass, it's way overthrown. The intended receiver downfield is Wolf, Roderick Wolf. Preseason, second team all-conference. Last year against the Hampton Pirates, Roderick Wolf came up with three receptions for 30 yards and a touchdown. Couldn't come up with that catch that time.
And they were going for him with the big play there. And Selby actually made a good read. He had one-on-one coverage with Roderick Wolf and Jackie Bates there with no free safety help. Middle of the field was wide open. Selby should have put a little bit more air underneath it to allow Wolf an opportunity to run underneath the ball.
Talking about Donald Hill Ealy's success here. Third winningest coach ever. Morgan State's history, and they've had some good ones over the years as Simpson gets the call, breaks a tackle, still on his feet, bounces inside at midfield, still going down to the 48-yard line before Jackie Bates finally corralled him.
We talked about it earlier. If Simpson could just make somebody miss quickly at the line of scrimmage, he's got that game-breaking speed. You'll see him get this ball in this delay counter here and make the first guy miss and turn on the Jets. Had Roderick Wolfe not lost his footing and put a block on Jackie Bates, Simpson could have still been running. But when you've got aggressive defenses that are doing blitzing for run stopping, if you can give them a little misdirection and hit them with a quick run, it can result in big plays.
And you see what Morgan State is doing right here. Here's a pass out in the flat, and it's caught on the far sideline by Surratt. And finally, he is stopped by Vaughn Mansfield, but Surratt comes up with the big catch that time. A gain of about 7 yards on the play. It'll be second down and three.
That was a great job of body control shown there by Robert Surratt. Ball's clearly behind him. Watch the adjustment. Snatch it out the air.
There's a timeout on the field as the third quarter comes to an end here in Hampton.
McDonough versus St. Augustine, Friday at 8 p.m. on ESPNU.
When hot, molten rock, ash, and gases erupt and escape from deep below the surface. It often results in a touchdown. For those who have what it takes on the inside, Russell has what it takes on the outside.
Women seem to be coming on to me in an unusual manner.
You're that, Charlie. When you have sex with someone and then they find their true love.
You got the ticket to the big show.
Oh. But tomorrow, the only one he wants is the one.
Now?
Where do I get this?
He can't touch.
If you sleep with her,
you'll lose her forever.
I gotta go.
Dane Cook, Jessica Alba.
Does your phone receive pictures?
Good Luck Chuck, rated R, in theaters everywhere tomorrow.
Are these numbers right?
Yes.
Do you know what this means? It means we have doubled in the last 6 months. It means we're gonna have to hire more people, move into a bigger space to get those key card things. But we'll need to order a lot more
wood.
What if this continues?
Dave, isn't that kind of the idea?
Citibank Business Banking. Whatever your growing business needs, Citibank's there with guidance and customized solutions to help your business thrive. Come to Citi and let's get it done.
Nissan Titan.
As we start the fourth quarter, 15 minutes of football left here at the Armstrong Stadium on the campus of Hampton University. And Chad Simpson in the backfield in the eye, closing in on the 100-yard mark for the fourth straight game. He has 84 yards in the game, and there he goes again. Still rolling, going forward, has the first down inside the 30 to the 28-yard line. So another big run by Chad Simpson before he stopped by Franklin Frazier for the Hampton Pirates. But there's a young man, like I said, closing in on that 100-yard mark.
And he's feeling it during the quarter break. He was excited getting into the game. And look at him make himself small and run straight ahead. His durability has been surprising. He's small and compact, but he's very strong. He's got a great set of pipes on him when you look at the arms. And very tough to bring back, and he's explosive. Had tough running here tonight. He has not backed down from the challenge as Morgan State has dominated in the second half.
So they certainly have. As Surratt went in motion, here's Simpson again, and Simpson is down to the 25-yard line. A gain of three. It'll be second down and seven. Marcus Dixon there defensively. And we talked about Chad Simpson in game number one, in which they beat Savannah State 47-7. Chad Simpson had 142 yards and three touchdowns. In their second game, in a loss to Towson by three, he had 195 and a touchdown. And in the loss by two to Winston a week ago, he had 221 and a touchdown, and he has two touchdowns rushing so far tonight and closing in on the 100-yard mark. Here's the play action. Quarterback, Selby's And he's brought down in the backfield, and nothing doing is Maurice Dixon and Desmond Stewart there defensively.
Well, you see Brian Selby held on to this football here, turned his back. They tried to use Chad as a decoy. Acts like he's getting the ball. Hampton wasn't fooled. The defensive lineman kept him in the pocket. He spun into Marcus Dixon, who was there for the takedown and the sack.
Right at 100 yards for the evening for Chad Simpson, and this is another third down situation. Third and long this time for the Bears of Morgan State, who are 4 of 11 attempts tonight in third downs. Now they're going without the huddle. They've been looking for the plays on the sideline as Jai Wilson goes in motion. Selby under pressure, and he steps right, and now he's going to take off and run it. Gets the first down. No, he's going to be shy by about 2 yards.
But I think more importantly, he might have put him in field goal position there.
That's important, like you said, Jay. This will be a 39-yard field goal attempt. The ball is spotted right at making a 38-yarder. It's spotted at the 21-yard line. So it'll be a 38-yard field goal attempt for, let's see who's going to kick this one. James Meade, looks like, is going to come on to kick this one. They have 3 kickers on this team. So 12:28 to go. Morgan trying to take the first lead of the ball game with a 38-yard field goal. High snap, blocked! And now the Bears of Morgan State cannot take the advantage and take the lead. So this one was blocked. It might have been Pope that came in there and blocked it. Or was it Joaquin Good? There's Good right there. Let's look at it. High snap. Yeah, it was Pope. Coming in from the right side, and we'll be back.
When you get into a Volkswagen, it gets into you.
Professional driver on a closed course.
Now through October 1st, get a 2008 Touareg 2 V6 for only $399 a month.
We don't need help remodeling our kitchen. I can do this. Trust me.
I have an idea.
The Home Depot is the answer. Our home services installers are pros you can trust who use the best materials. And right now, get no payments, no interest for 12 months on all installations of $299 or more.
My work here is done.
Honey, give me the hammer.
The Home Depot. You can do it. We can help.
Attention football fans, gear up for the season like never before with this NFL Performer Jacket with the logo of your favorite team free. Plus, this NFL collectible football free. That's right, get this Team Choice NFL Jacket free when you order 56 issues of Sports Illustrated at only $1.59 each. Save 65% off the cover price. Use your credit card and get this NFL football also free. As a special bonus, order at SIOffer.com and get this SI gym bag also free. With SI, you'll get the sharpest NFL insights and analysis, spectacular photos, and coverage of all your favorite sports. The SI Fantasy Football section, the must-have preview issues, and the sizzling hot swimsuit issue. And this Team Choice NFL Performer Jacket, free. Use your credit card and get this NFL football also free. And if you order at SIOffer.com, get this SI gym bag also free.
Call 1-800-234-9400 now. Call 1-800-234-9400 or visit SIOffer.com.
Here's Mr. Pope, the defensive savior for Hampton. Sam Pope came through to block the field goal there. You kicker, 3 field goals blocked this season. Meade has had 2 blocked with that one. And actually, that's the 4th time they've had field goals blocked this year, because Jonathan Skeet had 2 blocked both against Towson State. So they've had four field goals blocked, and tonight they're one of three in field goal attempts.
Yeah, I'm just concerned about the trajectory. We know about the high snaps they've been having, but the trajectory on this kick is kind of low. He didn't really have a chance, but looked like he was going to kick somebody in the back of the head had Pope not blocked that kick. But needless to say, they got issues in the kicking game at Morgan State.
Yeah, they do. They have three good. They have three kickers who are pretty decent. They just haven't been consistent. Skeet, Mead, and Bees. Bees is the punter. Here's a snap, and here's Van Morgan.
Wow.
Stopped immediately, stuffed in the backfield, and right there to make the stop defensively for the Bears is Anthony Young, number 94. Anthony Young, the senior out of North Versailles, Pennsylvania, went to Allegheny High up there last year. Eight tackles for losses, and coming into today's game, he had three. That's another stat that we see more of. Are you stuffing people behind the line of scrimmage?
TFLs, that's tackle right. For losses. Defensive coordinators dream.
They certainly do. Third down and 10 now for the Pirates. Under 11 minutes to go in the contest. In the fourth quarter here, pressure. Here's a pass out the flat. It's going to be knocked away. It was very close to being caught by Gilchrist, but what a close by the defender who came up, and that is Chris Williams, number six.
This is how you play cover two. He's responsible for the deep half. He gets over there to the third. You see him get there, swat this ball away. Great timing. They actually did a roll coverage there, and Chris Williams, his job was to not let anybody get behind him, and once you keep everybody in front of you, break on the ball.
Fourth straight punt for Jamal Blanchard in this ball game. And here come the Bears. They're coming after it, but he gets off a good one. Jai Wilson will not get to it. He does pick it up. He decided he's going to come up there and take a chance. And he stopped immediately by Joaquin Good, who was down there on the special teams. So Morgan State has tied this ball game up, coming from 17 points down. Donald Hill Illy's team trying to get something going.
You have to be here.
Good morning, NFL fans. It's Dick's Sporting Goods Fan Friday. So suit up with authentic Reebok NFL apparel and show your true colors. Every Friday this season, be prepared for fierce rivalries. Use every drive, every bump and run to go the distance. Wear your team out with authentic Reebok NFL apparel. Dick's Sporting Goods Fan Fridays.
Two outstanding Louisiana high school football programs face off. McDonough versus St. Augustine. Friday at 8 p.m. on ESPNU.
What do you want in a home? Everybody has a different idea, yet everybody should expect the same things in a mortgage. Introducing No Fee Mortgage Plus, only from Bank of America. No application fee or closing fees. No private mortgage insurance. Plus, close on time and best value guarantees. The opportunity to get the mortgage you've always wanted for the home you've always wanted. No Fee Mortgage Plus. Call now to get pre-qualified or go to channel 115 to learn more.
Always ask for Pennzoil.
ESPNU College Football presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. You have to be there. And in part by Dick's Sporting Goods. Every season starts at Dick's. Along with Jay Walker, Charlie Neal here in Hampton. 10:37, the time remaining. And this is the home opener for the Pirates of Hampton University, a team that is 16-1 against MEAC opponents at home since 2002. The last time they lost to a MEAC team was 2003, and that was to Florida A&M, 34-23. They do well here at Armstrong Stadium as Chad Simpson doesn't go anywhere. In fact, loses yards back to the 40-yard line. And Naaman Freeman was there to stop him defensively.
They're getting it done. You know, this is one of those games where you just got the feeling if Hampton is going to come away with the victory here, the defense is going to have to win the game for him. Mm-hmm. You know, because the offense is just being stymied. And if you're Morgan State, you got to think, if we just don't turn the ball over, our defense can win the game for us. And our defense is better than theirs, so let's just tough it out.
Surratt was the man in motion. Here goes Simpson reversing his field. Great vision. First down and across midfield, down all the way down to the 44-yard line of Hampton. And the first down is gained. Big run there for Simpson. He had lost a couple of yards. It took him under 100 on the previous play, and he got it back on that one.
Yeah, great vision. You know, when I just see Chad Simpson run, he just runs like an NFL running back. You know, so many times you see college kids like to dance in the hole. They're speed demons. They want to run sideways. He actually runs and carries himself like pro running backs do. He's a special talent.
114 yards for him today on 25 carries. And here he goes on the delayed draw. Has a little room to the outside. Look at the move he made inside. And I'll tell you, Kendall Langford is still trying to figure out where those shoes went.
he's doing it all. I mean, that's what you want. You know, playmakers don't let the first guy bring them down, and Chad Simpson is a big-time playmaker. I mean, watch his shakes. He's already showed us the speed, but he gave Marcus Dixon four jukes, then a swim move to top it off. That's the run of the year right there. That's the highlight reel right there. And I'm proud of
this. Look at Langford down on the ground. I mean, he can't figure out what's going on.
he was really struggling there, and it was tough. And the one thing, credit to Chad Simpson. You know, we said you had great yards on Towson. You had great yards against Winston-Salem. What are you going to do against Hampton? And those are the tough yards. Those are the yards that the coaching staff wants to measure. They want you to rush for 100 yards against the number one team in the conference. And Chad kind of had that wink like, I'm going to do something special for you tomorrow. And he's really come through with the tough yardage when they needed it.
They lost a yard on that play, and the clock continues to go down to the 8.5-minute mark here in the fourth quarter. And you talked about some great coaches at Morgan State. Eddie Hurt, 174 wins. Earl Banks, 94 wins. And of course, Donald Hill Ealy, the third winningest coach for the Bears of Morgan State. Third down, and we'll call it two. Quarterback. They're going to lose yards on this one. The ball fumbled out of bounds. Goes out of bounds and it'll bring up fourth down.
Wow. That's one of those ones there where that was almost that costly turnover there that could have did it. He's carrying that ball loosely, and sooner or later you knew they would catch up to it. Look at that loaf of bread. It's kind of loose. Does he really want this football? Not a hard hit that jerks the ball loose. Just trying to switch hands.
Joaquin
and got hit
good
from behind.
And that's Joaquin Good coming up, and he's been all over the field tonight. And we have a player shaken up. Is it the quarterback, Selby? That's down in front of the Hampton bench, or is that a lineman? I cannot tell. He was hit. It might be the quarterback. Would not be good news for the Bears of Morgan State if he can't continue. Here's a young man who last year started first half of the season for the Morgan State Bears. Surratt, the receiver, number 82, is the man that's shaken up on the play. Well, while we have a chance, let's go back to the studio. Lowell Galindo with an update. Lowell.
4 seconds left between Middle Tennessee State and Western Kentucky. Matt King with a 35-yard attempt to tie the game for the Blue Raiders. No good! No good! Western Kentucky wins 20-17.
Boy, wow. An opportunity to tie it, and you blow the field goal, right?
I'm telling you, Middle Tennessee State's got to be one of the best 0-4 teams in the country. I mean, I remember they were the first team that really exposed Louisville's lack of defense. Mm-hmm. They gave Louisville all they could handle.
You got a chance to see them last year down there at their place.
You know, great coaching staff there, and that's just a diamond in the rough. But to see them come that close to winning, they're still winless, but they're very competitive week in and week out.
So fourth down facing the Bears of Morgan State, and that'll bring on the punter, Thomas Bees. Jeremy Gilchrist is the deep man.
Mark that play down. That last play, third and one.
Yeah.
You know, a drive, they got a chance to clinch it.
There was two plays that they didn't. They had a second and one, and the running back, Simpson, got stuffed, and then they lost on third and one. They lost a few more yards. And
normally a championship team will make you pay when you make a mistake like that and don't convert opportunity.
Bees angling for the corner. And it goes out of bounds. No chance for a return. And they're going to mark it right at the 11-yard line. So that's where Hampton will get the ball with 7:56 to go and a tie ball game in Hampton.
Farm is proud to sponsor the Mideastern Athletic Conference. Call your local State Farm agent today.
Only the Nissan Titan has a Utilitrack cargo system and the longest crew cab bed in its class. You choose the tie-down points, you choose the angle. Because Nissan thinks when you put something in your bed, it should stay there. The new 2008 full-size Nissan Titan. The Titan of trucks. Now get up to $3,500 Nissan cash back at 1.9% APR financing.
No curb appeal. Hate the color. Oh, honey, this is it.
What you got there is an infestation.
A lot of life happens in your car. Conoco and 76 quality ProClean gasolines help clean your engine as you drive.
The pink wasn't so bad.
So you can focus on more important things. Conoco and 76 quality ProClean gasolines.
ESPNU brings you college sports 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The passion, the anticipation, the excitement.
Wide open touchdown!
Every season.
This is for three. Count it.
Every reason to watch.
That's gonna do it.
Every sport all year round. Tomorrow night at 7:30, news and analysis on ESPNU Recruiting Insider. At 8, Old Spice High School Showcase, McDonough 35 versus St. Augustine. ESPNU, always in season.
Back here in Hampton, of course, Morgan State has had a long tradition in football. These are Hall of Famers, NFL Hall of Famers. Lynn Ford to play with the Browns, so did Leroy Kelly. Willie Lanier, of course, with the Kansas City Chiefs. And Rosie Brown, another Hall of Famer from the New York Giants. And those are the people who represent Morgan State in the NFL Hall of Fame. Four from the Bears.
The NFL Hall of Fame. NFL. Not the MEAC, no. Not the Morgan State, the NFL Hall of Fame.
And, of course, there's a young man playing there now with the Minnesota Vikings, just signed a big contract, something like $18 million. We're talking about Shante Shinko, who's a tight end who played here for Donald Hill Illy at Morgan State.
Yeah, now they're getting paid now.
Yeah.
You know, he was a backup tight end. We're backup Jeremy Shockey for a number of years there.
The Giants.
Actually went on. Now he's a tight end with the Minnesota Vikings, and the tight end coach for the Minnesota Vikings is from the MEAC. Howard Gray, Jimmy Johnson.
Yeah, in fact, you know, one of the things that Coach Hill told us yesterday was that Shinko called him for advice because he was a free agent with the Giants, and as Van Morgan turns the corner and he was becoming a free agent, the Giants were going to offer him $15 million. The Seattle Seahawks were going to offer him $13 million, and Minnesota said offered him $18 million. He said, Coach, what should I do? He said, can you
count?
Can you add?
Can you add and can you subtract? And that's just Coach Hill's personality. When you talk about, you know, I'm a fan of Coach Hill. I mean, I'm open about that, because what I really like about Coach Hill is 20 straight losing seasons before he came to Morgan. And he gave a speech there after they had the first winning season. He said, the bear has arisen.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not going back into hibernation anytime soon.
Well, they haven't, and they didn't hibernate tonight. I'll tell you, look at the defense there on the running back. Did the ball come loose? They acted like it came loose.
Fourth down. They know they stopped him, and they've got a punt.
Yeah. But you know something else? You talk to Donald Hill, he's funny, because he was talking about his scholarship when he was being recruited by Joe Taylor at Virginia Union University. His grandmother got a scholarship paper. Didn't want him to take it. She said, $11,000. You're going to get $11,000? No, you may have to pay that back.
They're going to make you pay it back.
And somebody had to convince her, as you see Jai Wilson with the return. Somebody had to convince her that he should go ahead and take that scholarship. And he says now he sends a little something every other week when he gets paid. He said, I'm glad I didn't talk you out of taking that scholarship.
Aren't you glad I took that money?
He took over in 2002, the Morgan State Bears. Of course, they won 3 MEAC titles in their history in 71, 76, and 79.
A long time ago.
Yeah.
A long time ago, but he's always said this. He thinks this team actually has the talent to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, he really does. He likes his team, and I'm going to tell you, if he can find a leader underneath the center quarterback, they can go a long way because this defense is very good.
They are very good. And here's Selby in there, and Simpson on the carry. Simpson picking up a couple of yards, and a player shaking up for the Bears. Morgan State a little slow getting up is Robert Norris, the tackle transfer from Virginia Tech, number 70. But he's back up and under his own power, gain of 2.
I'm talking about Robert Norris. This is a young man that the coaching staff is ecstatic about. Yep. They say there's no doubt he is an NFL talent.
Let me tell you, he has quick feet for a guy his size. They say he's 6'4". He looks taller. Doesn't he?
Yeah, he does. I thought he was taller.
He weighs in at about 315.
We saw him just playing around in practice, and he looked like he was moving around like he weighed about 220. Freaking nature, you call guys that big with that quick feet.
Selby looking to go to the air. Now he's going to take off and run with it. Still on his feet. First down and out of bounds on the near sideline. But all the way down to the 33-yard line, or 34, is where Selby takes the ball. So Selby getting close to the 100-yard mark also in rushing.
Selby could be one of those street ball legends. I mean, you know, he's sandlot football. Hey, if I got a sandlot team, he's my first overall pick. Just drop back. Hey, it's not there. Breakdown run. Hey, you get him. You block him and just let me run the football. He's playing great sandlot football here on a national stage.
Yeah, go down to the rock and make a right. Huh?
Yeah, and stop at that yellow car and I'll hit you.
Wilson again in motion. There's Simpson, and Simpson still carrying people with him on his back, and he's very close to, if he doesn't have, another first down for the Bears of Morgan State. He may be a yard shy of a first down. That'll be second down. We'll call it 1.
Well, now let's see if the Bears learn from their previous mistake when they had this situation, their last series, and couldn't capitalize. Look to see some very conservative play calling here. I'd call 2 quarterback sneaks.
Simpson,
the first time.
Simpson, the 4th game this year that he's had 100 plus yards rushing. 125 so far in this one. Wolf in motion. Here's Simpson still ahead. And Simpson has the first down with plenty to spare. And he's inside the 15-yard line. Down to about the 14. First down and 10. Finally, Vaughn Mansfield came up to make the stop for the Pirates of Hampton University. Mansfield returned a fumble last week against the Aggies of A&T, 41 yards for a touchdown, but he needs to do a little more today to stop Mr. Simpson and company.
And one thing that Morgan State has to be careful of is Selby's getting away from that center very slowly, so the run plays are very slow developing because his quarterback center exchange is not clean.
Pretty clean that time. Simpson hit in the hole, and he was hit by Joaquin Good, and Good brought him down. 49 met him in the hole. Norris down again, a little slow getting up, and he's been ailing here. He's got a little problem with his giddy up. They may let him come out for a minute.
Wow, you can't afford to lose your best offensive lineman when you got to run the ball, when you're relying on the running game there. So let's hope he just goes out for a play and he'll be able to return during this drive. They can't afford to get him later. There is no tomorrow for Morgan State. Game's on the line right now if you want to win it.
Now let's see who will come in to replace him in that offensive line. That'll be Eric Fair, number 69. who's also pretty quick, out of Columbia, Maryland, a junior, 6'4", 290-pounder. It is second down. Jai Wilson in motion. Simpson caught in the backfield by Marcus Dixon. He was there. It's like he knew the play.
And where did Marcus Dixon come from? The right side of the line, which is right where Robert Norris just left the game. So Dixon has cat-like quickness for a guy his size, and they try and do a down block. You can't leave the best, one of the best defensive linemen unblocked.
Yeah, Marcus Dixon was there. He read the play all the way, and it brings up a third and 13. The ball all the way back at the 18, but again, manageable. Even if they don't make it, don't do anything to take yourself out of field goal range.
You said it right there, Coach Neal. They've got to make sure that I would run the ball here again, actually. Run it towards the left, try and do a quick hit and play.
They're going to throw it in the air, maybe intercept
it. It is.
Why? Doesn't make sense. Jackie Bates was there on the receiver, and that was Wolf. Now, let's see. Both of them come up with it, but Bates actually did a better job of getting that ball. You know, you just keep the ball, run a safe play. You've got a 35-yard field goal, and you take the lead.
I mean, you just can't do this. Through this fade route here, they reacted to it. You like to see your cornerback try and make sure that ball doesn't get intercepted. They went to their go-to guy. Actually, Bates, that's great defense right there. He just won that battle.
He did. They drove from their own 46 down to the Hampton 18-yard line and throw an interception, their fourth turnover of the game. And that was one of the things that concerned Coach Hill-Ealy coming into this game, was turnovers and those types of mistakes and penalties. Turnovers and penalties.
Been in the driver's seat. You got
the
a defense.
Penalties they've taken care of today.
Take care of the penalties. Defense has got their number. All the defense really wants is 3 points. And they were playing like they could have secured the victory. Going for the touchdown there. Wow.
Well, they're starting. That is the only, I guess, saving grace for the Morgan State team is the ball is at the 1 yard line and the Hampton Pirates are backed up. And let's see if they can come out of this. They're throwing long. Here's a band there. McPherson has it.
He's out of bounds, I believe. Are they saying he was in?
McPherson has it. So that is his first catch, I believe, as a member of this team.
Wow.
Actually, it's his second catch. The first one was for minus 4 yards. It's his second reception since transferring from Illinois.
I thought he caught this ball out of bounds. He came
now.
He
got that right foot down. Got
that right foot down. Knowing that he was going to get hit.
Out to the 29, so a 28-yard pass reception for McPherson. From transfer from the University of Illinois. T.J. Mitchell's going to take off and run with it on the quarterback keeper. He's hit down. But not before he gains 9 yards on the play down to the 38-yard line for the Pirates of Hampton.
Well, that was one T.J. Mitchell there saw with zone coverage and let those linebackers clear out, and he just replaced where they were.
So, you know, and you talk to Donald Hill-Ealy, and he talks about how much Joe Taylor means to him. He says if it wasn't for Joe Taylor, there would be no Donald Hill-Ealy, especially in the coaching profession.
I was trying to start something, you know, see if, hey, you guys started a rivalry yet, coaching type of rivalry, and he said, it'll never happen.
Never
will always be my father, and I'm going
to T.J. Mitchell under duress right there. Brought down immediately by Kofi Nkrumah.
He's played a great football game.
Yes, he has.
You know, whether it's been coming up for run support or getting back in pass protection or pass coverage, Kobe's made some big plays when the Bears have needed it.
2:06 and under 2 minutes to go. The clock running. We could be looking at overtime here. I see the president has come out of his booth and he's down on the sideline. He's talking to his kicker. He said, you got to get it together. Can we get in field goal range? T.J. Mitchell again looking out in the flat. Lets it go. Has it complete. And Kyle Lloyd has the first down. They move the chain. They keep the drive alive with a minute 33 to go as Dakota Bracey came up to make the stop. And there's the field goal kicker, Turavani, who's missed one earlier tonight, but he's also hit one. working on the sideline. Let's look at the play once again. Well, I guess we won't. It is first down and 10 at the 45, their own 45.
Morgan's getting ready to bring pressure, trying to blitz up the middle.
Empty backfield for the Hampton Pirates, trying to get in field goal range for Turavani. Pressure is coming. Almost intercepted. Right in and out of the hands of Chris Williams, who had an opportunity to save the day for the Bears right there and kill this drive. Let's look at the receivers here. What happened?
I mean, this is actually supposed to be a screen. I don't know where he was going with that football, too. That was one of those designed pick plays. And the pressure to T.J. Mitchell made him release the ball early to somebody he just thought was wide open. So he got away with one.
Yes, he did. A minute six to go. Clock stop. Second down and 10 for the Hampton Pirates. All tied at 17 here.
They are bringing everything but the kitchen sink at T.J. Mitchell when he's back there with nobody to block.
Five receivers in the lineup for the Hampton Pirates. Under pressure. This one is caught. And right at about the 45-yard line, Chris Williams there on the stop defensively of McPherson, who had the big catch to keep this drive alive. And he picks up another 5 yards, and the ball is right at midfield. Under a minute to go, and a timeout being called. And there you see again on the sideline warming up Carlo Turavani, a freshman from Niagara Falls, Ontario. He's hit a field goal here this evening from 31 yards out. He missed a 36-yarder, so he is 3-for-4 in field goals so far this season.
You know, and if he thought he was a little nervous
against Howard,
if he gets an opportunity here, there is no other type of pressure that a kicker can face than this.
It's always a lonely position. You know, these are the guys who nobody catches balls for him in practice. They kick it out in the parking lot, and he has to run out there and get it. He's hit people's cars and everything else here on the campus.
Just like a quarterback, you're either the hero or you're the GOAT. There's no in-between for the kicker.
Very lonely position even in practice. It is third down and 5. And even if they don't make it, they have to go for it on fourth down to try to get in field goal position. They have to get to the 45 of Morgan State to keep the drive alive.
Blitz coming again by the Bears. They're bringing everybody.
And they read it pretty good. They try to set up the screen, and they get it to McPherson on the near side. And he's still going to be a little bit shy, maybe a yard shy.
I think he got a favorable spot. Wow.
Yeah.
He got the old right foot spot there.
Yeah, he did.
Wow.
Yeah, they got the first down. 47 seconds to go. Somehow, some way, McPherson, the young man that started his college career at the University of Illinois, then matriculated here to Hampton University, a couple big catches on this drive.
Yeah, wow, that was a great effort.
28-yard catch, and this one good for first down, good for 6 yards. Time is clipping. Teal in motion. They're trying to set up a screen, and they get the receiver, Morgan, killed on that one. As Gerald Guyton really came up and tattooed him, didn't he?
I mean, that's what you want your linebackers to do. Your defensive linemen and linebackers are responsible for stopping the screen, and they got pressure on the defensive line, forced him to throw the ball early. That ball hung in the air for a little while, and Gerald Guyton tattooed Van Morgan.
No question. He put his number on him, didn't he?
Yes, he
number
did.
11. So Van Morgan tomorrow when he wakes up, he's going to see number 11.
Number
in his
11. It'll be something else. And, you know, the key thing, you know, the only thing that Morgan missed on this drive is when you're going to blitz, your secondary has to make the open field tackle one-on-one. So they forced Hampton's quarterback, T.J. Mitchell, to get rid of the ball quickly, yet the defensive secondary could not come up and make the one-on-one tackle in open field, knowing that Hampton was going to get rid of the ball quickly. So I think that's the one disappointing thing that the Bear defense did on this one. And then had they had the ability to tackle, they would have got the ball back.
Morgan State Bears, 2 losses by a total of 9 points this season. They lost to Towson 29-26. That's a three-pointer, and they lost by, actually, they actually was by was it, maybe it was 28-21 to Towson, and then they lost to Winston-Salem 19-17. They lost that one on a field goal with 1 second remaining. They had just taken the lead with a minute 43 to go. It took the lead, well, a minute 13 to go, and then came back and lost it. And here's the quarterback, T.J. Mitchell, going out of bounds, stops the clock with 12.6 seconds to go. That was a second down play, and he may have picked up another first down or very close to it. But more importantly, they have to get in field goal range, in range for Giovanni to get to the, be able to kick a field goal or at least have a decent opportunity or chance to take it.
And depending on whether or not they got that.
Yeah, they're going to measure for the first down to see if they got it or not. But, you know, we talked about the fact that both of these programs have done a pretty good job of getting some Division I players. And we talked to Joe Taylor a little bit about it the other day, and he said, you know, a lot of these kids we've recruited anyhow to begin with. So they're not unfamiliar with us when things don't work out wherever they decide to go to school coming out of high school. He said, and one of the things we do is we recruit. And, you know, one of the things you got to take your hat off to, they do get the first down. One of the things you do have to look at Donald Hill Illy. He has a great recruiting base in the state of Florida.
He does. I mean, you know, we talk about Morgan, how they rebuilt the Bear. You know, it's not just in the state of Maryland, even though they're playing good football there. They call it North-South recruiting.
Yeah.
And when you talk about South, they go way South. We're not talking South Carolina and Georgia.
Way down there.
The state of Florida.
Morgan State team from Miami Edison High. Gerald Guyton, Chad Simpson, Edward Baptiste, and Clarence McPherson all have factored into this ball game tonight.
And then the Northern players, they've got 10 players from New York and New Jersey, combine that area together. So North-South recruiting has been very effective for Coach Donald Hill Ely and staff at Morgan State.
First down and 10 for the Hampton Pirates. 12.6 seconds to go. They're going to have to get in field goal range. Pressure on the quarterback.
Oh, fumble.
He fumbled the ball. Let's see
Morgan
who has
it.
Morgan has it with 4.8 seconds to go. The third turnover by the Pirates of Hampton today.
They're going to get a flag for Morgan State lineman taking off his helmet on the field.
How dumb can you be, right?
It won't hurt him, but if they were thinking about it, that would have got him. They caught Charles McPherson taking his helmet off, and they're going to get a personal foul after the play.
Dead ball.
After play, unsportsmanlike, number 9 on the defense. He removed his helmet, threw it in the air after the play. 15 yards from the end of the run, first down.
I mean, he had a fantastic effort on the play there. The Morgan State defense doing it. Watch him come here. You see him there going on the left side of your screen, taking his helmet off right there on the play.
And see, you know, we heard Coach Ely talking about commitment yesterday. And commitment in a lot of ways, quarterbacks and receivers staying after practice or coming a little early to get the job done, those are the types of things that create losing as opposed to winning.
When you take the it's all about me mentality, it can divide up a team quicker than anything else out there when you're trying to play a team sport.
So they're playing for overtime here at Armstrong Stadium. Hampton University just going to wind up not being able to get the field goal, and Morgan State decides, hey, we're just going to take a knee. We're going to take a break. We'll come back. We're going to overtime here. The Bears have pushed the Pirates. We're in overtime here at Armstrong Stadium for Thursday night primetime college football. And here's the overtime rules. There'll be a coin toss for the choice of offense, defense, or which end of the field they want to play at. Each team gets at least one possession from the opponent's 25-yard line per overtime until the winner is dedicated. No game clock, play clock only. Teams must go for the two-point conversion if we get into the third overtime. So that's the rules for overtime.
Visit team, so you call it. So, tail. Head. You got the ball. You want the ball?
He's not sure. He called tails. It was heads. Which end of the field do you want?
No, they picked the wrong one.
Right.
Hampton won the toss. They will have the ball first on offense.
Now, TJ is politicking, saying he already said that he wanted it down here. He can't change his mind.
And you know what? And you know why they want to defend down here? You hear that, you hear that music?
The
there
band.
You go. You hear that music
yeah,
going?
Sure.
They want to make Hampton's offense go
into
the
band. That's right. But we may not have been here had this play not occurred, because rather than trying to get into or keep it in the field goal range on a third down play, they threw the ball. It was intercepted by Bates. Or was that, yeah, Jackie Bates. And, you know, here we go.
And Jackie Bates went up and got that ball. Great position. Bates was a shorter guy, and quarterback was trying to do a jump ball situation, but he actually overthrew the jump ball pass, and the defensive back was in better position than Roderick Wolf was, and Wolf couldn't even play defensive back and stop Bates from coming down with that interception.
There was only one score after 27 points were put up between the two teams in the first half. Only one touchdown in the second half, and that was Simpson's five-yard run with 9:14 to go in the third quarter. That tied the score at 17 apiece. So now Hampton gets the ball to start the overtime. And it's all tied. They say if you're going to get Hampton, this is the year. Well, they've been pushed here. Here's TJ going back to the air. Under pressure, decides he's going to run out with it, and he will not get away from the defense, being brought down that time by Justin Lawrence, number 52.
They give credit to the secondary for Morgan State. Hard play action pass. They're in man coverage all the way, and they're running with them, and nowhere to go with this football. Flushed him out of the pocket, and bare defenders all over the place. And take a look here, Justin Brown all the way on the backside. He had an inside route there, and the quarterback had time in the pocket. Might have been able to deliver a touchdown.
It is second down and 10. Gilchrist in motion on the end around. He is picked up again.
There go that man again, Charlie.
Nkrumah. He's been all over the place tonight. If there's a defensive award to be given for this particular game, he would get it. This is College Football Prime Time, presented by Buffalo Wild Wings. And it's the Football Championship Subdivision, a MEAC matchup between Hampton University and Morgan State, along with Jay Walker, Charlie Neal. And immediately following our game, we'll be sending you back to the studio for SportsCenter U with Lowell Galindo and company. Right now it is 3rd and 15, though, for Hampton University.
I don't like the soft zone call here. They should be coming out in some more blitzing man-to-man coverage, trying to force it.
And we have a touchdown into the end zone for Hampton University is Justin Brown out of Surfside Beach, South Carolina, right outside of Myrtle Beach.
They were having so much success pressuring the quarterback, making him get rid of it quick.
You saw it and read
it. 3rd and 15, they played a very soft cover two zone. Hampton attacked the weakness of the cover two, which is in the middle of the field. Justin Brown split the safeties for the touchdown for the Pirates. Look at that. Wow.
Just off of the outstretched hands of one of the defenders from Morgan, that would have possibly knocked it down. Turvani for the point after, which is good. And now we're going to have a whistle. Let's see, what do we have, a penalty?
Illegal substitution. Illegal substitution. Defense, 12 men on the field. Half the distance to the goal. We'll re-kick.
See, I don't like to.
I just take the points.
I don't like to say, let me have the points, but he's blowing the whistle. The referee, the back judge, blowing the whistle. And so, you know, this could be an adventure. Even though it's after this is the goal line, it's not automatic.
Maybe they're just trying to tempt them enough to go for two. So, hey, Coach Taylor, you think you want to go for two?
Well, again, Turvani for the point after. And it's a 23-17 ball game here. Hampton scored all of its points until this overtime touchdown in the first half. And it is good. So TJ with his third touchdown for the third straight game of passing. And this one goes to Justin Brown.
Look at the middle of the field, wide open. You got a linebacker there in the zone, threaded between the cornerback, the safety, and the middle linebacker. Weakness of the cover two. Soft, soft cover two by the Bear defense on third and 15.
Yeah, from the 35. That's what it was. So it's a 24-17 ball game here in the overtime. And now Morgan will get the ball. They have to score a touchdown. They don't have a choice but get it into the end zone. This one's incomplete. Thrown a little bit behind Surratt. He had to twist his body around to try to make that catch. And it goes incomplete, and they are facing a second and 10.
Yeah, Morgan doesn't have the type of offense that's designed for second and long plus. But, you know, this is four down territory. With the pressure knowing you have to score, that gives Hampton the advantage of being able to play a little bit softer, and they can come up and just tackle. You don't have to win the battle of the trenches. You just have to keep the ball in front of you.
Last year, Morgan only lost four conference games. They were 4-4 in the MEAC, and those losses, one to Hampton, to Delaware State, South Carolina State, and FAMU. And this is their first conference game of the season. And here's Chad Simpson, and Chad Simpson, they're waiting for him. A young man who went into the overtime with 141 rushing yards. He picks up a couple more there. And it was Vernon Bryant who came up to make the stop on the defensive side of the ball for the Hampton Pirates. Is a third down now, third and 8 facing Morgan State. Ball resting right at the 23-yard line after that 2-yard gain by Simpson. We are in overtime here in Hampton. The Pirates leading 24-17, first possession for Morgan in the overtime. Selby, plenty of time, throws into the corner. Nobody is there. Misread between the quarterback and the receiver. There were more blue jerseys over there than there were white jerseys.
Yeah, game on the line, miscommunication there. And I think in this case, you got to come up with some trickery. You got to go for some misdirection right now.
You only have, this is fourth down. Yeah, this is it.
But you haven't shown the ability to drop back and complete a pass against this defense. So I don't know if you maybe get Jay Wilson in motion and try and stick it to him on a reverse with he and Chad Simpson. But you want Simpson to touch the ball, but you can't give it to him in the backfield.
Not here. Maybe give it to him in the middle of the field.
Too high.
Ah, game's over. Game is over. Hampton University comes out victorious in the overtime, 24-17, and they know they win a ball game.
They escape with the victory here at home of the gutsy effort by Morgan State. But yet, say what you want about the Pirates. To be the man, you got to beat the man. The last time I checked, Charlie, Hampton is still the man.
No question about it. And, of course, Hampton University will be home against Delaware State next before they go up to Princeton. Once again, our final score, 24-17 from Armstrong Stadium in Hampton, Virginia. Be sure to tune in next Thursday as we present primetime college football, Norfolk State and A&T. For Jay Walker, Charlie Neal saying let's head back to the studio and join Lowell Galindo.